Good evening. Welcome to the April 5th, 2017 Board of Selectmen meeting here in the Town Hall. We have a lot of stuff on our agenda tonight. Minutes of March 22nd. Have you had a chance to look at them, guys?
I have not.
I did.
Okay.
I did before.
You're pretty much okay.
I just haven't had a chance yet, but go ahead.
No, go quick.
Let me take a picture.
While Trevor is reviewing the minutes, I just want to put a pitch in for the tick season. The tick season is going to be really bad this year. That's what the Department of Public Health has sent out messages about, and the state that Catherine Brown has been talking about. It's just they're predicting a very bad year. So with the warmer weather, people are going to be outside in their yards. And one of the things that I've found is really, really effective is to, this is $6.95 at Tractor Supply. It's just Bronco Equine Fly Spray. But what is in it is permethrin. And that's been around since 1979. The military's been using it since 1990 in their clothes for, you know, protection of the troops. And what you do is you take this spray and you spray your boots or your shoes, and that will keep the ticks from jumping on your legs. If you have pants on, obviously spraying your pants is a good idea. It does not harm your clothes. I would not put it on directly on the skin. Kip and I were just talking about that, but I think this is one of the most effective things you can do. If you have animals like your dogs, this you can spray the legs. I spray my horse's legs, my daughter's dog. And what you do is it will keep the ticks from jumping on you, and I can say it really works. This is the best, cheapest thing you can do. This will last all season, and it's very effective. The other thing you can do is you can just buy this 99-cent lint roller, keep it in your back pocket, and you can rub your legs up and down to get the little baby ticks. They are so tiny, they're the size of a pin, and you're just not going to see them. So anyway, what's critical here is that we know, because of tick tests, of ticks that have been submitted to the University of Massachusetts for testing, about a third of our ticks have Lyme disease, and between 5% and 10% have some kind of secondary bacterial infection. So it's very important that people pay attention, because it has huge ramifications. It's really epidemic. So again, it's Bronco Equine Fly Spray. You can get it at Tractor Supply, $6.95. It will last you all season. You spray your shoes and your boots or pant legs, that kind of thing, and the lint roller. The other thing you can do in your yard, it's a lot of work, but it's a pain in the neck work, but really the vector for ticks is mice. So you can get rid of your mice in your yard, or else you can take a toilet paper roll that you put contact paper on or packing tape or something, make it a little bit waterproof, stuff it with cotton balls or your dryer lint that's been sprayed with this stuff, and the mice take it to their nests, and it will kill the ticks. So cleaning out the ticks in your yard is one of the things you could do as well. So anyway, there's my spiel on public health.
I'm good.
Okay. Do you want to make a motion?
I make a motion to accept the minutes of March 22nd, 2017.
I'll second the motion.
Is there further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Select board comments and announcements. Do you have any?
No.
Do you have any?
No, I'm good right now.
Okay. So I have a couple. The Homeland Security meeting yesterday, they came up with they finished the family unification plan, and they have the activation checklist and the template. And Trevor, I had asked Pat to make you a copy.
I did. I got a copy.
Just at some point review it, and that we can work with the schools. And
I plan to bring it up tomorrow at the meeting.
Okay, because what I'd like to do is, when we do this FEMA drill, that we have somebody from the schools representing.
Involved, yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Okay.
Yep, I'll bring that up.
We are planning to do some kind of training. UMass is working with us on this to have, because reunification is a huge thing for them. So we are really excited because we're going to practice it. And then if there's any, after the action report changes, we can get that done before October. So
great.
I'm kind of excited about
okay.
that.
Okay.
While you're on Board of Health, I have something else for you.
Oh, sure. Okay. Well, this is select board stuff, but, I spoke to Adam Costa in Lisa Mead's office, and, we had talked about the marijuana stuff. We still have time, and so I think if it's okay with both of you guys, let's have a special town meeting, because the planning board didn't move on the zoning.
Right.
We have to, before April 1st, I'm sure they're going to move the date, but right now it's April 1st, 2018. We have to have our sales tax adopted,
yep.
and we have to figure out how many pot shops we want all yep. the, and where we
where
want.
Where they're going to want.
So we have to decide whether we want a moratorium, 20% of our liquor licenses, or one based on our dispensary. So
okay.
And where we want it. So
right.
we need further discussion. But Adam said we can do it in the special town meeting. We don't have to do it this
okay.
town meeting.
And
it
we'll
does not have to be.
That.
It was misinformation to say it had to be at an annual meeting, which
okay.
is what I understood. The REPC meeting yesterday, I talked to John Taylor. He's the fire chief from Shelburne, and he's the one that does all the ICS 100 and 700 NIMS.
Yep.
He is willing to do a two-night class here for our town hall staff, any of our volunteer community volunteers. I was hoping to
nice.
Do this in June. And if you could look at your calendars, because this was you
I
guys
could, do,
could
this.
Do you guys could do it.
Yeah.
But he wants two nights, like a Monday and a Tuesday. I told him would probably be better for us.
Yep.
Sure.
Is there
I would just later in the day.
Oh, it would be like 5
Yeah, it'd
o'clock.
Have to be. No, yeah.
I was talking more like 7, but
oh,
it's just hard,
yeah.
depending on weather, I don't know, I might not be able to get here that early.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. So you would like 7?
Yeah.
All right. What? Wendy, do you think we could ask town hall people to come as late as 7?
I think there we can invite everybody, but I think there are certain people we should tell we really need to have them.
Yeah, okay.
So we'll work on that when we get closer to it.
The idea is to get prepared for practicing all our plans and
ICS 100.
It's ICS 100 and NIMS 700, and the idea is to get as many people trained.
What does NIMS stand for?
National Incident Management System. It's just your basic stuff. It's not, but it's we do use it.
So the
it 12, does work.
12th of the 13th is that?
June.
Yeah, Monday, Tuesday, 12th, 13th seems to be okay.
What's stay in your lane.
Yes. Good.
Really? Well, what it is in an incident, it's
chain of command.
And yeah. I feel like what yes, and I
it
feel like we haven't practiced it because we haven't had our EDS drill for the last couple of years, and so
mm-hmm.
it would be good to have all our volunteers. We can update our volunteer list. We can invite community members. We can make sure whoever hasn't had it can get it, and that also makes us eligible for all kinds of emergency grants because that's one of the requirements. And the other thing that they had at the REPC meeting was that the Tier 2 compliance, only about 50% of the people have responded. So Bob Strand is going to make sure the Greenfield Fire Chief is going to send Wendy a list of who hasn't complied. It was due March 1st. So there are several companies not in compliance. And what I thought we could do is just when you get that list, Wendy, could you just run it by Chief Swayze and Chief Yuzlinski and make sure that there isn't other companies not on that list that haven't complied? I mean that they're aware of.
I missed the beginning of what the list
the Tier
is.
2 list. It's the hazmat.
Okay. Yeah.
They would know. I think I gave you, Trevor, and I because I had an extra copy, and I can give you my copy of the FERCOG climate change adaption.
I just saw that. Yep.
Yeah,
on my desk.
I got
I'm going to
that.
Read that.
I went to that meeting. It was not a lot of information, new information, but they. What I do want to check is they have a list of all the culverts in town for
okay.
us and the crossings and the condition, and I want to cross-check it with Kevin and that Tim Corey's who's, has a possibility of giving us a grant for
right.
culvert replacement.
Okay.
I think that's it from
okay.
a Selectman's point of view. So now we're up to Board of Health comments.
Actually, it's something fairly minor. It was an
okay.
inspection that Charlie did. I sent it to you, and it was a Title V compliance. Someone was inquiring whether their septic system was good. They just recently bought their property, and it
okay.
was good. So I'm sorry, I thought it was more prominent.
Okay. Great.
The only thing I could say is just ticks and mosquitoes. We got to watch out for those mosquitoes. Charlie is going to come to the April 19th hearing.
Oh, good.
On
Thank
the
you.
Budget to talk about the mosquito district, so that we'll have some more information on that.
Yep.
We are getting, we're going to get clarification on the ditch, clearing the ditches like on Bloody Brook, as you noticed coming down. There's quite a lot of standing water in Bloody Brook and Blackstone, and so we're going to get clarification how much potentially that might cost to dig that on the under the district, because that was a concern that it was a too much of an expense. But
well, I walked that area behind the school yesterday, and you know there is that there's a couple areas for mosquitoes of concern right by the playground. It is always wet. I mean, I know it dries out really dry season, but it really is there quite a bit. I don't know what can be done there, but I walked the brook back there as well, and it just definitely congested. There's a lot of stuff that fell in the fell in there. It could probably be running better and emptying out more if
yeah.
some
well,
of the culverts and stuff were cleaned underneath the walkway between here and the school. And
yeah, well, that you know, you can get a backhoe
mm-hmm.
and for $2,000 a day. Does that sound reasonable? Because that's the quote I got. If you hired somebody like
$2,000 a day,
yeah,
can I do it?
No,
no.
Some, is it expensive?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
if we
most,
call
most
I,
people charge between 95 excuse me 95 and $135 an hour.
Oh, okay.
So maybe
okay.
$1,000 a day.
Yeah,
$1,000 a day
yeah.
is better. Oh,
yeah.
I'll have
yep.
to put that in the because they gave us a quote of $2,000, and I thought, ah. Oh.
The mosquito district?
No, not the mosquito. The people that are putting the budget together for the you know, potential costs. And
okay.
so but that's good, because we can get somebody like Holcott to come in and do
sure.
it under the auspices
well,
of the
why couldn't the town has a nice backhoe.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can't. That's the problem. That by going through a mosquito district, you are exempt from wetlands. You can do it under a wetland without
I get
wetlands
that, but
permit.
You're only exempt if you're not the town.
Yes.
Oh, geez.
No, you do have to do
okay.
it under, exist, under
right.
the district. So that makes a difference. So I just need to know how many days it will take to trench that out to give that.
Because
Bruce Hunter raised the expense of how much that potentially could be. And I really didn't know, have an idea. So if it's $1,000 a day, how many days work? I can maybe get.
Well, that could be a lot. It could take a week, maybe.
So it'd be about $7,000, maybe. But that's
five.
Huge if people, because that reduces the flood problems too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But anyway, okay, we'll go on. So, town administrator's report.
I'll give that later. It's all tied up with the warrant and
yep.
okay.
kinds of
okay.
We can do that.
Your
so, Joan,
full.
Do you want to come
your
up?
Your desk looks full.
You can introduce
yeah,
yourself.
We have to be scheduled for 6:45
yeah.
at
yeah.
7. So, yeah. I yield the chair.
How are you?
This is supplemental material to what Joan is going to be speaking about. It's colored.
Okay.
Thank you very much. My name is Joan Joshi, and I'm working with the Franklin County Continuing the Political Revolution, which is an incredible name for which I apologize. However, they have a number of task forces, one of which is working on health care. I have just learned that about 5:00 tonight, the Republicans have given up with their next second attempt to write a health care bill. And frankly, what Trump promised during the campaign was not feasible, simply mathematically impossible to do. So the New York Times in its editorial tonight said what they're going to slide into, happily, is a single-payer plan. In the meantime, an organization called Mass Cares has been working to introduce a single-payer Medicare for All plan in the state of Massachusetts. A similar action is undertaken, is underway now in California and New York. And I'm not, they're not finished with it or ready to introduce it yet, but it's coming along. And as you probably know, Senator Sanders is about to introduce a national bill, which of course, which in my view would be the most sensible thing of all. However, Massachusetts has been a leader in healthcare reform, as you know. It was the Massachusetts plan that became the model for the Affordable Care Act. And it is my hope that if we cannot yet accede to a national plan, that Massachusetts will be able to initiate this and start it on a state level. So what I was asking, what our committee would ask you to do, is to introduce a warrant article which asks that the town of Deerfield endorses the House and Senate bill, Improved Medicare for All, and will communicate its support to the town's state representative and state senator. And I've given you some other information about the healthcare plans and what it amounts to. There's a chart that I have found particularly interesting that shows that we are the most expensive healthcare provider in the among all the industrialized countries, and yet we do not provide the same outcome. Our female life expectancy is 81. In Japan, it's 87. And we have do not do very well on infant mortality, mm-hmm. really shockingly right. bad for a country like ours.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of other statistics put out by the World Health Organization, which shows that we are sort of 37th in overall performance in their 2012 review. And interestingly, we are number 17th in the World Happiness Review. Mm-hmm. As you may notice, it was Norway that comes out on top this year. And that is because people do not worry about things. I mean, that whether you ever use your insurance or not, the great benefit of it is that you don't have to worry. And I'm a Medicare recipient myself, and let me tell you, when I turned 65, that was the happiest thing that happened to me, mm-hmm. that I never had to worry about health care again. I do pay some extra for supplemental care, mm-hmm. so frankly, my medical care cost me nothing. And that's, at my age and in my financial condition, a very happy state to be. Mm-hmm. But I do believe that health care is a right and not a privilege in this country. We are the most the prosperous country in the entire world, and it simply doesn't make sense that we are so far down next to other countries in the quality and the accessibility of our health care. So I'm sorry that we got started too late to permit me to put a warrant article myself, mm-hmm. but if you could do it, we would certainly support it, and would hope that you'd use the bottom one, that you would ask the town meeting to endorse the bills.
Wendy, you have a warrant with the resolution.
Yes, I have one with it and without it, depending on your vote tonight.
May I ask a question?
Please.
What weight is this warrant article supposed to have?
Well, we're trying to get all the towns in Massachusetts to endorse it and encourage the Senate to take it up and pass it.
There's no
there's no other obligation. It's just we support
just
it
support.
And hope that you'll move ahead
well,
on it.
Fiscally responsible.
When you talk about the premiums, our premiums this year alone have gone up about 10%. So mm-hmm.
yes, you've seen the study
you say the savings to this town are about $200,000.
That's right.
And the savings to the staff is about $200,000.
That's correct.
That's probably three. The rates that went up.
I was just going to say the calculations I think are pre rate increase, but calculations are done, who did this calculation?
I did.
You did. Okay.
Based on the wording in the law, it's in the draft, in the bill, sorry, it's not a law yet.
Okay. So is this information going to be available? Because obviously it makes sense from a sustainability point of view. Mm-hmm. This is a huge expense for us, and anything that will make it more sustainable is better. So is this information going to be available at all? Can we put this on the website?
Bring it to town meeting.
And town meeting? have this for free.
Yes, surely. That's
okay. I mean, I think that's really important that people get the context of it and have all the information.
I'd love it if you could put this chart in as well, because I think this is very telling.
Okay.
But that's up to you.
Do you have a copy that Pat can... Could you...
Yeah, I've got
a copy.
Yeah.
Pat got the copy?
You have everything you need?
Mm-hmm. Okay. We'll put it on the website as information to the...
Wonderful.
Once we put the whole warrant package together.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, there's the information sheet too, but whatever you think is necessary.
And if people have questions, they can... Is it all right if Pat... forwards the questions to you?
Sure.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Pat, if you can get her email.
I have that.
Okay. All right.
So the bottom line of this is it's a push to have the government run the healthcare system.
That is correct.
A single payer system, right?
What is otherwise known as democratic socialism. That's
well,
the countries in the Scandinavian countries which fight each other as to which is the happiest. Have that. In fact, as you see on the chart, all of the major countries in the world have this. Canada, the United Kingdom, Switzerland, every country is listed on that. We are number 11 out of 11, and we spend more than $8,000 per capita on health insurance in this country without getting the results that we want, because other countries put a lot of money into preventative care, which is much cheaper in the long run.
I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. I use the United Kingdom's or, you know, the UK's plan when I had my kids.
Uh-huh.
When we lived in London for 3 years.
Uh-huh.
And I have to say, the Well Baby program was amazing.
Yeah.
And the clinics they had in every neighborhood, and it was just down the street. And my son used the South Korean system for 6 years, and he said it was excellent. So.
I had a baby in Germany for nothing once, right?
Yeah, I had mine in England for no cost, zero cost.
Right.
Well, I had one in Northampton for free, too.
Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
Your time.
Thank you for your efforts. So do we need to vote on that? Or are we just going to put it on?
Well, we'll sign the... do you want to vote on that, or...
Whether to add it to the warrant.
I personally don't agree with it at all, but I don't feel it's my job as a selectman to stand in the way of something to go in front of the town meeting. So
yeah,
under
okay.
that,
thank you.
I have no problem with
okay.
it.
Okay,
appreciate that.
That's good, because we'll just use the warrant that has it on as a resolution. Yeah. Okay, next item on the agenda is David, and anybody else that wants to come up with David.
David White.
Hello, David.
Good evening. Kathy Troba.
Hi,
Kathy.
Hi.
Woody.
Yeah.
Hello, Woody.
Yeah. I just learned I have about 30 more years to live. That's nice.
Yes. We'd like to stretch that a little longer if we could.
I was like, wow, 81, really? I got some living to do.
Good evening. I'm on the agenda tonight to address two issues, water and traffic. I put in a request to be on the agenda for the planning board. I have the email that says planning board, April 3rd. I was put on the selectman meeting, which is post the planning board. Okay, so there is a...
I'm sorry about that, David.
Yeah, there is addition to agenda.
You have us. You have us.
What's that?
I said you have us.
The town lost 48 hours. Anyways, so we'll talk about the water first. New development should be sited and designed in a way as to not exacerbate flooding or runoff. That's a statement from the town housing production plan. Okay? We have asked since the beginning on this development to calculate the amount of water coming off of Mount Sugarloaf onto the Sugarloaf condo project. I'm asking to expand that, and let's take a look at the residents of Eastern Avenue and Mountain Road that have been hurt by the water coming off of Mount Sugarloaf as well. I have to find my page here. So tonight I'm asking the town to hire a professional hydrologist to look into this matter before any further developments are made, so that we proceed correctly and limit the town's liability in the future. There's no need for us to be going down and throwing mosquito larvicide in standing water in Crestview, and I believe that happens. Okay?
Actually, David, what I'm going to do is forward your suggestions to the planning board and the town lawyer. So if you can be concise about them.
Okay.
Actually, I don't think it's actually a bad idea to document the current situation so that we can follow it and be clear of
and
what...
And define the liability when and if it occurs.
So the current situation meaning...
Do people have water in their basements right now?
Yes.
What is the situation in some of the surrounding areas?
What about statements from individuals that neighbor previous development and the before and after in terms of their water?
Well, I think there is an understanding that the Crestview development did not take into consideration that was a receiving area before. I know we discussed it here, and
sure.
I asked Kip to make sure that the water was being addressed because we were concerned about, here we are trying
sure.
to raise money to have a form of mosquito district and all that kind of stuff. The last thing we want is to consider, make conditions,
sure.
more conditions. So I was very clear that we needed to follow up on that, but... my understanding is that they did calculate it as a receiving area, water coming off the mountain. But if you have a hydrologist to verify the conditions, then they could also
yes.
look at the...
Whenever you develop land with swales or trenches or foundations, you create a hydraulic disturbance. That needs to be defined, where that water is going. Not only coming on, but now it is exiting into existing neighborhoods. I don't know where that water's going. You don't know where the water's going. I was told by someone that, it just went down the brook. Well, if all that water goes down the brook, you're going to have a problem with Sugarloaf Brook down by the Olszewski's house. We don't know if it's headed over towards the town pumps. We don't know if it's headed out towards us in the Boren lot. We don't know if it's backing around. Common sense would say that the water wouldn't back up and go towards Eastern Avenue. Maybe it's not. We have to look at the whole situation in that area because the potential liability for the town is there. And I've been trying to bring that to people's attention since last July. Okay, real quick. Never addressed how many gallons coming off Mount Sugarloaf. Water leaving the site. Infiltration in the ground. Where is it going? As an example, my ground in my backyard undulates with the level of the water every year. You can see it go like this. The water is there, okay? It needs to be looked at before you put 70 houses in. You could build the Taj Mahal out in that field. You could build a cancer research center out in that field. You need to look at the water because anything you do out in that water is going to create a hydraulic disturbance that affects the existing neighborhoods. I can't say it enough, okay? And in capacity with the water, the storm sewer. Now, I don't know who owns the storm sewer, the storm runoff, not the effluent from the houses, but that has limited capacity. Now, this potential development has designed spillways that will go into that storm sewer. Are they going to consume what limited capacity there is if it is limited? We don't know what the capacity is on that. In my lifetime, I've seen those storm sewers back up. When you go to develop Oxford Pickle, or someone comes in to do Boren Ave, you're going to have more runoff, not less. You've got to look at this stuff. It's just this rush to rubber stamp this project. I am not against senior housing, affordable senior housing. I am not. But you've got to look at this stuff before you ruin existing neighborhoods.
David, did you have other conditions that you're concerned about?
Sure. The traffic. Oxford Pickle, the Boren lot, which is defined by King Philip and West Street, the lot behind the post office, all potential development sites adding to Sugarloaf Street traffic. You got the New Cumberland Farms. Now, they say it's a net on the traffic, but I tell you what, go down and look at the nightmare that's the Pride Station in Northampton, the corner of Damon and King Street. Mm-hmm. People coming into the new store will find, just like the water coming off the mountain, the course of least resistance. If that means turning right and coming into town and backing up, turning down South Main Street to go to Northampton, they will do that. They will continue down Sugarloaf Street if they're going to Amherst, leading to more traffic. People aren't going to fight their way across 5 and 10. They will find the path of least resistance. You have to hire somebody. We have not seen any lines across Sugarloaf Street doing a current traffic study.
I did look up traffic studies. I think the most current one we had on Sugarloaf was 2014.
And how'd that work out for the town? Our streets are inundated with traffic. We're not only looking for a study, we're looking for potential remedies.
Okay.
We're not spending, we know the traffic's bad. We don't need to hire somebody to tell us the bad. We're looking for remedies. Okay? Next, at the Board of Health meeting, at the Planning Board meeting the other night, a member of the board stated his reason for voting for the condo project as there was dust and chemicals blowing in his yard from agricultural fields. Now, I was unable to determine that, but if we have dust and chemicals especially, blowing through Eastern Avenue, Jewett Ave, the old entrance there, somebody from the Board of Health ought to look and find out what these chemicals are, because this man used this as a basis for affirming his this development.
Mr. Ellis.
That is, if there's chemicals, let me know about it.
Well,
that's what he said.
I heard what he said.
It was foolish.
You've got to listen.
Thank you.
There's a lot of farmland around here, and I did some research. And last year, there was 3.5 million pounds of toxic chemicals spread on the land in Deerfield. And when that chemicals is in the soil, and we get a dust bowl like we did a few weeks ago, where do you think those chemicals are going? All over the place. You want to stop it? Go to the state and tell them to ban all of these chemicals. Don't allow the farmers to use it. See how far you get there.
Okay.
It's part of reality.
I brought up the use of ethyl dibromide on the tobacco lands as a fumigant. Mm-hmm. That was in the 70s and 80s. If anybody remembers, they were the yellow, the 55-gallon lime green drums. They had a red diamond on it with Dow written in it. Mm-hmm. In 1977, when they created the HERP list, human exposure rat potency, that chemical was the number one cancer-causing agent in the United States, and they dumped it by 55-gallon drums on these properties. Never mind the aldecarbs. I was the one who said, you have a agricultural brownfield, and I was laughed at, and now you're telling me the same thing. I agree with you.
I understand.
No one's looked at this lot to see if there's any chemicals left.
That's not something that we can actually discern at the moment. Okay. So
sewer commission.
Okay. That's something that we can do.
I think that the town should require the future development in any of them to pre-treat the sewage entering the system with mechanical grinders so that there's no added, maybe it'll extend the life of the infrastructure down at the sewer plant.
Actually, David, that's an excellent suggestion, and it has been suggested already. And I think we make that list yesterday from Bob Decker came in. And
those were just three requests to the plan.
Okay.
Sent it to
yes. Well, we'll send. That's actually good because we have so many problems on Captain Lathrop and
yes.
other hookups.
Yes.
So having a grinder installed on both streets where the hookup come, you know, before hooks.
But those streets are gravel fed; they're not a pump station.
Right, but they're fairly flat, Kip. So
no, they're gravity fed; they're not pump station. The problems that we have at Captain Lathrop Drive is because it's a pump facility, and the handy wipes, the dental floss, or any other rag material that's in there gets caught into these pumps, and that's what creates all the problems. Every other house that's on the sewer system in Deerfield is a gravity fed, just like proposed condo project. And unless the problem happens right at the sewage treatment plant. That's what the Headworks project is for.
But we've, in the last 2 years, if I don't mean to interrupt, but in the last 2 years, we had this problem on the corner of North Main and Captain Lathrop. We had the same type of issue on Porter Street. And again, on Sugarloaf Street, where a sewer pipe burst into someone's basement, mm-hmm. not once but twice. And they came out and fixed it only from the house to the sidewalk. It burst again, filled their basement with raw sewage. The town paid for this cleanup, which the cleanup alone was $7,000, not to mention that this house had this massive amount of contaminant in it. They had to go back and fix this pipe from, it was actually broken at the road level. So these are pre-existing homes with a single family structure. And in 2 years, we've had three major bursts. And we're going to add to that, at the east end of Sugarloaf Street, 72 more homes.
But into, those issues...
But into a system that we just don't know how strong it is and how safe it is. I just wanted to add one more thing. So we've fallen asleep at the wheel a little bit in terms of this drought, right? So we have some water tables that are very low and, you know, dust and particulate matter blowing around. And, you know, what is the remedy for that? But I have to say, looking at Sugarloaf Street and looking at retention ponds and worrying about airborne illness in relation to mosquitoes and bacterial growth, in the DPW, there's a retention pond. So that's west end of Sugarloaf Street. In the center of Sugarloaf Street, there is Crestview. With retention ponds, you could swim in. They're huge. Nothing against the residents of Crestview. They have every right to live in their home. When we reference Crestview as a development that flooded Eastern Avenue, we're not criticizing anybody. We're just stating that this was an aquifer issue that came to bear. So there's two retention ponds there. And, I mean, they're deep. They're huge. We're looking at another one at the east end of Sugarloaf Street. There's a lot of population there and a lot of risk when we do, in fact, get our water tables back up to what would be typical. And that's a Board of Health issue, and that's a concern for me as a resident because one of them is right behind my house. And, you know, we live in our yards and in our home, especially when the season's nice, and it's a risk.
We do treat a little bit,
okay.
And we are trying to get on top of it.
Yep.
Is there a mechanism for the town's residents to suggest, restrictions on the, recommendations of what should be done on this project, or is it?
Well, what I wanted you to do was, do you have? I've been writing down stuff, but
one construction time, the major road should be put in some time frame. Feasible, whatever. This shouldn't be a 7-year project with people with construction going on in their yard. The property values are going to suffer enough, I believe, without having an open construction project for 7 years. And I'm talking the heavy construction of the road. A limit should be put on the amount of time to build the infrastructure and get it in place. Okay? I think that a performance bond should be placed to protect the town and the residents on most capacities of this
building. That's already been suggested, and I think that's on the list.
Okay.
Good.
I don't have any issues with that because...
Now, I have a question. The town master plan, where do you see that?
The master plan has been expired.
For how long?
I think it expired in 2010.
Okay, so when it was referenced by Mr. Whiteman in the letter threatening the 40B to me, from last September, he quotes the town master plan and planning board subcommittee on housing findings. How much of this is current and how much of this is smoke and mirrors? You're basing a project, the need of a project, on a study that's outdated, and you're going to affect our neighborhoods with an outdated study, okay? And again, I go back. I'll give you a little vision for the town. You take these ball fields, you go down there and you buy that land, you limit the size of this and scope of the project. You limit that land, you take down there and put a town park down there, move these ball fields here, and put your affordable senior housing, rent subsidized, over where center field is here. And that way you have it right close to town in here. You're destroying the center of the town. You're destroying it, the whole thing. Okay?
The master plan does mention multiple times the character of the town, the character of the neighborhood, the vitality of the town, and, you know, our position is and has been that a subdivision, just the word subdivision is problematic to me, but a subdivision of this scale is, in my opinion, excessive, and it's not congruent with the character of our town. I have incredible concerns about Sugarloaf Street and this granted waiver for the 285 feet. I just think it's incredibly excessive. It's a greater than 50% acceptance, and it's going to have an impact on Sugarloaf Street and not in a positive way. And I think we have to take into consideration the scale of this development. And, you know, we too, Mr. Whiteman said over and over and over again, I'm following the plan. Well, so are we. We're referencing the same plan. And in the same plan is contradictions to his own statements. I mean, we can go back and forth on this all day long. But if you know, we want to maintain the character of our town, I think the scale of this development is, as a member of the community had said to me when we were collecting signatures and getting people's voices for their discontent, that it was greedy. Every blade of grass is accounted for. Every inch is built on. And to me, it's excessive.
David, do you have the list that we can give to Wendy to pass on to our town lawyer?
I will. Because I have other notes on here.
Well, if you could
also
wrap it up.
Yep. I understand that the town moderator is also the lawyer for the developer. Is that accurate?
Used to be. Somebody just said used to be.
Is he changed? Is that changed? Or?
He is.
I think he is.
He is, currently.
He is. Does anybody find that as a appearance? Appearance of impropriety?
No.
I mean, I want to go to the town hall or town meeting to do a warrant, and I've got to hand it to the. It's kind of like.
Well.
Thank you for your time.
Mm-hmm.
I will supply a letter to you, a list of.
Okay.
Is tomorrow morning enough time, or do you need it in the meeting here tonight?
Tomorrow's fine.
Thank you. I want to go and go to sleep. I want to go back. I want to go back to my house and
there's just
disappear.
A
but you have to look at this before you go forward. You have to.
Emily Wolfcole from Mountain Road. And just following up to a question that David asked, but that I think we got off track with, was what is my understanding from the planning board meeting is that town residents could, in fact, request certain conditions for the development. And I'm wondering if, in fact, that's true, and if so, what is the time period for that?
The way you stated that, that's incorrect. The town residents can give input to the planning board, but they have no authority to put any conditions on any
request.
Project.
Absolutely,
you know,
no,
so
well,
it's a matter of a request.
But the board
but
can.
That would go through the planning board.
And I believe that's the 18th.
You
so
can go. You can go to the meeting on the 18th. But you, I mean, let me give me a quick second here to think. Technically, you can't because you had an opportunity at Monday night's meeting to do that, and we closed the public hearing, so we cannot take any more information from the public.
But didn't Mr. Wade say that?
That's sort of a.
I thought that was in the context of that we could reiterate our concerns that potentially could become part of the conditions.
Or does the planning board not want to hear any more about it?
I think that's a pretty slippery slope for the community to go down, because once you close the public hearing, you're not supposed to take any more information.
Well, maybe it was
from
close.
The public or
maybe
the developer, correct?
Yeah. If correct. Mm-hmm. We can ask questions, but we can't take anything from.
You can't
public.
Change anything you said.
Well,
we can ask questions of the developer as the planning board puts, you know, conditions on.
Well,
the
who creates
the
conditions?
Town attorney. The town
that's
attorney
why I'm going
to review
to
all the promises that were made here over the course of the last whatever since the beginning of the process. You ought to review the tapes and review all the promises that were made in portraying this development.
I think the lawyer is going to recommend to the planning board. Certain things, like one of the things has been promised over and over again is that it was over 55. So I'm assuming that the condition would be deeded
over 55.
Even over 55, sorry to interrupt, but even over 55, what the legal counsel had stated was that the person on the deed had to be over 55, but that doesn't mean, that just means one person has to be over 55.
On a piece of paper.
But that's correct, but at least the town has the protection of saying... he was granted the waiver based on his presentation of being an over 55 community. So if it's a deeded over 55 community, there is at least semi-protection. And that's one of the things that our lawyer would recommend.
Who would be enforcing or policing this? It seems like it's all in the hands of private ownership.
Well,
now.
It is private ownership.
It's over. It's
quite gone. Quite honestly, it can't be enforced 100% because
so it's kind of
nowadays,
talk.
I mean, there are a lot of grandparents raising their Absolutely. Grandchildren. So, you know, but if
so
it's
then
a deeded,
offer him a downsized
if it's
project.
Deeded, if it's a deeded 55 and over, at least there's some protection.
All right. How serious conditions can be applied now that they've already stamped the project as approved?
Well,
can they approve
the planning board did not stamp the project approved.
Okay. What?
There's too much I don't know where people come up with this stuff, but it's just,
close.
You're so wrong.
All right.
You are so wrong.
Can I just say something?
Sure.
And I appreciate you making that statement, because you're right. We I don't know if we're misinformed or uninformed, but, you know, I guess my question is, what you know, constitutes the waiver? Because as you read in the paper and you look at these waivers, and I'm going to be honest and tell you, I was quite... surprised by the waiver for the curb cut. I mean, I just think it's so excessive. It was 50 feet, 42 feet, but 315 feet is greater than 50%. I was quite surprised by that. So what I read in the granting of those waivers was an acceptance, but that's an assumption. And maybe there needs to be some clarification, even through the paper or the website, to say what the stage that you're in and what that actually means in terms of the project and its rubber stamp approval or not. Because I think you're right. I think there's a lot of people that don't have clarification on what that is.
The waivers at that meeting on Monday were granted based on the information that the planning board had going forward. Just because something says like the catch basins need to be 300 feet apart and they got a waiver, it was simply because if you take a catch basin that's here and another one's here, you have a distance of travel of 300 feet. That's what they're trying to do, get the water off of the road. In this particular case, they were 400 feet apart, but there was a crown in the road, so the distance the water travels is 200 feet. And that's why that type of waiver was granted.
When Max Annie's voted against it and stated that if you grant these variances, you might as well rip them out of your rule book, he was snapped at by the chairman.
Yeah, it was interesting.
He was snapped.
He was criticized for criticizing the...
That's not what we're here to discuss tonight.
I'm just a little curious.
Dissent has been...
In relation to this waiver for the additional access road, so what is that waiver stating? That he can put the road in?
He can put the road in, yes.
And that... additional road is what allows him to have the scale of the development that he has. Is that correct?
No. Okay. It could have one entrance.
It would be the same?
Scale, but
yes.
One entrance? But the reason they wanted two was for the safety vehicles, like the fire trucks and what have you.
Well, then make that one emergency entrance and get this traffic.
Or does that second entrance basically allow his currently owned second property to have legal road frontage and go up in value? Maybe that's the reason for the second entrance.
I think what's really unfortunate about this whole thing is that we have so many unanswered questions and we really don't understand the process. And it's it'd be great if there was some access to a document that helped us understand it better. Because when you're getting information in weird bits and pieces and you're making assumptions, then... you get reactive, and that's not the
best. And it is upsetting, I understand.
The only thing that I can suggest is that, the plans for that and all the documents have been in the town hall.
And I've read them, and it doesn't necessarily, at this stage, you're right, and I've read them. I have it at home. I brought one of those home.
Did you take the engineer?
I read, and I do my homework. But what I don't know about is where we are right now and going forward. What does that mean and what does that look like and what do these waivers constitute and are they rubber stamped or is, and according to our legal counsel, he did say within these requests, these waivers, the board has, you know, some room to move. You can make decisions within it, and they were made that night.
Yes.
And not only did the professor from UMass and as well as our legal counsel say, this is not a lot of time. 4 months is quick. I don't understand why we're like.
Yeah, what's the rush about it?
They haven't even determined the water yet coming off the mountain.
Because he wants to build fast this spring?
Well, we can't speculate.
One other thing in closing.
Okay.
Tom probably should consider replacing the planning board or using the planning board as an oversight and hire a professional planner. I started reading the planning board rules. You got to be a lawyer to figure those out. And a lot of the people on the board are using personal opinions to make a decision that's affecting other neighborhoods. Maybe it's time that we hire a professional town planner and take the politics out of these decisions because they are loaded with politics.
Well,
and that's the nicest thing I can say.
What I'd like to say is I've been on the planning board for 3 years, and I'm quite frustrated by a lot of things that go on. And so I looked into that. And we can hire a planner, but the bottom line is you still have to have the planning board. You have
as
to
oversight,
have,
yes.
No. The planning board is the decision-making people. The planner is just the arranger.
Was it proper? The lawyer came in here the other night, and one of the board members told me that he learned more in 15 minutes from the gentleman than he had known in all his time on the board. So there is an amount of you just can't be a layperson and know all the rules and regulations. I'm reading them here now. It's mind-boggling, this whole condition system here.
It is.
You can put conditions on it. You don't have to ask him to accept them. He has to accept them. If he doesn't, if he refuses to accept them, then you pull the waivers.
But it's a complicated area because I personally totally dislike our stormwater bylaw because we have very similar rules in our subdivision control laws, but we do have the stormwater bylaw. It's inconsistent with state regulations.
What is the stormwater bylaw? Is that the one that says that you cannot put, do you have to hold the water on the property?
You got to read it. It's 163 pages of, you know, and even if you ask your neighbor, she's going to have a tough time.
Where does it say that you can put a spillway and consume all the capacity of the town sewer, the town storm sewer?
David, make sure you give the information to Wendy. I took some notes, but I want to make sure that you get that to Wendy.
I'm going to ask that I have a day or two to do this because I will huddle with the 215 people that signed. I will huddle with the 215 people that signed petitions asking. We're not here on our own. 215 people from town signed petitions to address the water and address the traffic. The other night, one of the gentlemen on the board was keeping score. Well, half the room is this, half the room is that. There's 215 voices out there that want this looked at before going forward. And I beg you, slow down, because you're going to change the town forever. The town is changing fast enough. You put this in here, you change the whole makeup of the lower South Deerfield.
I know you wanted to address the planning board on this, and you weren't on the planning board agenda, and you're not on our agenda, but you know we will forward the information to the lawyer. But I have to say that unfortunately this is, you know, other than being sewer commissioners and board of health, this, we don't really.
Well,
have,
I understand that. That's why also the other thing I learned is that you have 20 days after the decision is rendered and filed to file an appeal, and there's basis for an appeal here. Because of certain things were skewed with the process selecting, the developer got to select his judge, peer review.
That's
the moderator has been working in the capacity as a lawyer and a town official. There's more than enough. So if you wanted to go to appeal and tie it up and spend some money, we can do that. Or we can start addressing the issues that the 215 people in town are concerned about.
David, you just need to encourage them to come to town meeting and submit your resolution to the at that night to the moderator. You need it typed out so it's correct. Marusa, we're cutting
it
off.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming in. I know you're distressed. And,
okay. Thank you
very much. Yep. Okay. Next item on the agenda is Wendy, your report.
Okay.
Do you want to just...
Do you want to talk about the warrant right now?
Well, we can go down and... Well, let's talk about that RV repair.
We'll do the little things first. Yeah, you want to do the RV
repair. Now, they're looking for a recommendation.
Got the handout.
Yeah.
I need to know where 707 Greenfield Road is.
Pat knows a bit about it.
Yeah, okay, Pat, can you give us a little bit...
Do you know
bit?
Which building that is?
It was my understanding that it was the metal building between the 5 and 10...
It's when it sits back off the road.
Yep. Between the walk and the 5 and
yep.
10.
Yep.
Right there. I believe. Okay.
And the house, actually.
I don't believe that building has a septic system.
It does not.
So it's going to need one.
It doesn't
right?
have, I don't believe it also
I
has
think
water.
I'm planning on putting one.
So,
Do, is, there,
let's
is,
see,
there enough, is there
it
enough
says,
property to perk?
Have
I mean, to
used.
Have
I don't know.
I don't know.
Did you read this? Did you read this?
No.
Okay, it's in, there's a packet in there, and it's got some stuff about what he wanted to do and how they plan to use it. But I didn't...
comments from other town officials.
Yeah, and I didn't see anything on a septic, though.
Dick said he had no Board of Health issues.
Dick said there's no Board of Health issues? There's no bathroom.
On his Board of Health. He gave comments as the Board of Health agent.
Maybe he's
going to do that separately, apparently.
Yeah, maybe he's going to put in a septic system. I just wanted to make sure that, I mean, we don't even know if it really perks. But
I guess
my comment would be from us would be we want to make sure that it has a septic system. Right?
So, yeah, my comment is I encourage business in town, and I'm really excited that they want to open a business here. I just want it to, obviously have a septic, have some water, whatever they... You know, whatever it needs to be legal, but I'm excited that people want to move to Deerfield and open a business.
And I have to say, the only thing that I am concerned about is, yes, I mean, we don't want to seem like we're anti-business at all.
No.
But we just want to make sure that the site is attractive in the sense.
Yeah.
You know, there's not smashed up vehicles out front.
Correct.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just.
Yeah. Exactly.
We just...
Condition of the site.
Yeah, the site conditions need to be, make sure they're just...
I think that because it's a change of use, it would have to go for a site plan review anyways.
Come through the planning board.
Go through a planning board. Yep. And it would also need a special permit from the Zoning Board of Appeals to run that type of operation, which is not allowed by right in that area.
In that area?
Yeah, or anywhere in town, actually.
Okay.
A repair business, you mean? Or yeah. What?
You have to get a special permit for it, regardless of where you could do it.
Really?
Our bylaws are so strict.
Like a, you know, like the,
yep.
the auto,
watch.
The Rick's and
yep.
repair,
yep.
and everybody's,
yep.
they get a special permit to
yep.
do auto repair?
Yeah, by right.
Interesting.
Well,
okay.
Part of that is the.
Well, you don't want
the
anybody
conditions.
Just sticking,
right.
yeah,
so
fixing
conditions.
Everything on the side of the road.
And that would be.
What's that?
He can do the site plan review after.
Yep.
ZBA.
Well, if the ZBA isn't going to grant him a special permit,
there's
then
no sense of
what,
going
no sense
the
of
site
going
plan.
Through special. I mean, going through site plan review. Okay.
All right.
So, Wendy, the only thing we're really concerned about is make sure that there's a viable septic system, and the appearance of from the street. And we welcome all. You know, we welcome someone trying
yeah.
to start a
what
business.
We can do to help that.
Yeah.
Be great.
Yeah. Oh, that's all right.
Recycling.
So, Wendy, the next items on the agenda are the warrant. So why don't we go talk about?
So what I have here is so you basically approved adding a resolution on about single payer.
Yes. Yes.
The
we.
Very end of, okay.
It's yeah.
So,
I didn't think because it's a resolution, I didn't think you'd have a problem with it.
No,
I mean,
no.
Trevor
and
I are.
Like I said,
yeah.
I don't agree with it, but you know, it's not my position to stand in the way of what
no,
let the people
Thank
vote
you.
For what they want. You know.
Okay, so this is how I remember the difference. This is a list of the articles, and this is the warrant. It's for you know, could pass that down, give you each one.
Okay.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Okay, so I got to throw away. I think I had.
I know you made. Excuse me, several.
Can you recycle this so I don't get confused with the one?
Yeah,
that's the older one.
So this is not terribly different from the draft we've seen before?
Yeah. Let me just make sure.
So, where would you like to start?
Do you want me to highlight yours?
What's that?
Do you want me to highlight yours in the corner?
You mean just so it's a current?
Yeah, so you know that it's a current.
Okay, good, thank you.
Do you want me to do yours too? Because this is, we've had three versions of this, so. Okay, so this is the one we're talking the 4/5/2017 version. Well, do you want to just go by, let's go article by article. And if any of you have a question, I mean, most of these are, you know, pretty regular articles. So, number one is, article one is just the reports of the boards.
Mm-hmm. Who gives their select board report?
I think that is actually the
town report.
Oh, okay. So nobody has to read it.
So you'd like to make a speech.
I'll think about that.
Okay.
And we do, Pat is working on the town report, Bob Decker. Bob Decker is the guaranteed person, one of the few in town that absolutely reads it cover to cover. So I want to reassure him that we are doing it.
And you're going to write one for the.
Yeah. I will, if you guys can email me or call me with what.
I thought we were supposed to email.
This is for the prior fiscal.
No, this is for items to put into, it is not an open meeting violation.
It's not a deliberation, right?
No, I'm soliciting stuff to put into the select board report.
Okay.
But it would actually be, I think, for the two of you, just 3 months, right? Because they joined, it's for that former year.
Well, it's like, I think we write our town report fiscal year. Is that correct, Skip, Jeff, Bruce?
That's what Brenda said, so.
You got me, right? Somebody has to tell me.
I think we do fiscal year. What happened in this past year?
No, it's
from July,2016 through June.
Get my crystal ball.
July 1st, 2016.
I bet I could actually get a few things right.
No, that's this year, it's the previous year.
No, it's June. 2000,
July 2015 to June 2016.
Right.
Yes.
The prior year.
Yes, it is the prior year.
Not the one we're in.
You're right.
So we've only been here half the year.
God, it feels like longer.
Yeah, so.
A couple of months.
If you guys.
What are
so if you have anything you want to add, would you please just think of it and email me. Otherwise,
All right.
I'll just throw something together.
Sure.
And sit with Wendy on it, okay?
Okay.
I mean, I feel it's important to have.
So we're just supposed to tell our views of what went on
in
town?
Well, like the sewer committee.
Sewer committee.
What you're working on.
You know, what are you doing with the sewer committee? The roof, school roof.
Mm-hmm.
Could you give me a bullet on the school roof?
Yeah.
That was a huge process.
Or take a bullet.
I'm going to tell the taxpayers that we spent $425,000 on three firms for engineering, OPM, and.
They're all going to love to hear that.
Kip, positive. This is a positive, upbeat thing. So.
But they should know where the money's going.
But this is my report.
You're right.
You want me to write it, so I need positive, upbeat bullets. So, would you please tell me positive, upbeat bullets about the sewer treatment plant? You know, I mean, the committee.
It's still working.
No, I meant the committee. I mean, that's a wonderful.
Well, we're still working too.
Process.
So.
That's a wonderful process.
This is for FY16. They didn't exist.
Well, yeah, you've been working on this little stuff.
FY16. It ended June 30th.
So that's a month.
But you met a little bit.
Nope.
You didn't meet at all in 16?
Nope.
Wait, well, we did in 16, but not in that year.
Right.
And
it was
after.
August of 16.
August, right.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I guess I can't put that in.
No.
So you'll, and for the finance committee, you'll have to go get Dylan to write it.
Right. I saved a copy of the financial report from last year that we did for the handout for the town.
There we go.
If that would be of any help.
That would be helpful.
That would be really helpful. That, do you want to make, if you want to make any edits to it, can you just edit it? If you want to make any edits to it and give it to Pat, so we'll put that in. Because that actually is a good summary.
I'll present it to the finance committee this Tuesday night.
Okay, that would be lovely. Actually, that's wonderful. Jeff, that's a good solution.
Okay.
Well, I guess then you guys aren't really putting in a lot of effort. But you know what? Just think of some things.
All right.
You were there for a month. You were there for a month.
It was a crazy
month.
Well,
I do remember the first week I saw plans for a $3.5 million addition to our sewer treatment plant, and I said, no way. That spawned a lot of good discussion, so
well,
that's all
there
the
you go.
But you know what? We formed...
$3.5 million.
No, it should have been more like $30 million. It was
nope.
30.
I
know.
No, it was just
that
for
looks
the building.
Like pretty darn
it was
good.
Just for the building and the headworks. Yep.
I'm.
And that.
I would have taken $3 million.
And that is what we paid $130,000 for, unless we can get to work
well,
with
would
that.
You formed because of your observations. You formed the sewer commission committee. Okay. You started the roof process. You got involved in the roof process. So that's two things that you could about, okay? Would you just think about a couple things?
I will help you out.
Because there really was some positive things. And Trevor, the same thing.
Yeah.
Just try to think of something, okay? All right.
I started to meet everybody.
That's important. We have two new board members, and that's wonderful. Okay, next article is the moderators and select board, assessors, school committee salaries. That's pretty much, I don't think that's changed from last year. We just list them. No.
Well, if we could go back and put the same one that was on the schedule last year, that would be fine with us.
That was on there.
Not the amended one.
Well.
Sorry. Too late.
Too late. Okay, Article 3 acknowledges the gifts that we receive, and we'll list those in the motion, right? That's,
good.
You know, the donations.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We list them as gifts because
yep.
they don't have to do anything. Article 4 is the Dickinson Library. That's a standard article.
Mm-hmm.
Article 5 is, this is new, Wendy. Can you?
The Municipal Modernization Act changed, simplified, allegedly, a lot of procedural fiscal operations. And this is, the motion will have a similar box or the similar listing of the revolving funds and amounts.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But this is the new language.
Okay.
And I don't think you need to go back every year necessarily to do this.
I was just, I think that's it. Okay, Article 6 is for to cover the contract, the police contract.
Mm-hmm.
Article 7 is the comp study. Now, the comp study is the one that... Okay. And so that... And that's what you all, Bruce...
The comp study, will that include language relative to the second year of the comp study, whether it be used or not? Because our understanding at the public hearing that this is a just a one-year project, one-year plan. That's what I heard.
That
can that be reviewed in the future years?
That can be in the motion. The board would like to do
more. Was that your recommendation? Or, I mean, how did you vote on it as a finance committee?
We haven't even seen the evidence. I mean, we've seen the draft.
So
we haven't voted on it.
Okay, we'll sort that. This will be the comp plan, and we'll sort that out. That needs to be sorted out in the motion. We'll have to sort that out.
So is the article going to change?
No, because
Well, we'll determine what.
No, this is a generic article.
Yeah.
The motion is.
The motion is what will determine what we're going to do.
Okay.
We'll sort that out. We need to. We're going to have a meeting next week. I know, Trevor, you can't come.
Next week.
The 12th, because that's you're going to be.
Right. I may be able to get back in time, but we'll see.
Okay.
Well, if I can, I'll be here.
We're just going to, whatever we don't get done tonight, we need to finish up for next week, because the 19th is our town.
The pre-town meeting.
Yeah, pre-town meeting. That seems to work out. We are going to do the explanation, and Charlie Konecki is going to come talk about the mosquito stuff and things like that. So you can get more information on that.
And also next week will be a combined, first part of the meeting will be a joint meeting with the Capital Improvement Planning Committee under the bylaws found out today.
Yes.
We need to have a hearing.
Yep.
On the plan.
Program, the capital budget.
Right.
And been in touch with John Reskin, who sent it to the capital.
Yeah, I have the capital plan for that is proposed, and then what John is going to do, or what John has done, which I think is an excellent idea, is to give us a more long-term plan for the stuff, and so. And we have a couple additions, but we'll get when we get to that article, I'll bring it out. I have it here somewhere.
Okay.
And what we wanted to do was it's here somewhere in my paperwork. What I wanted to do was add the cemeteries. That wasn't on there. We've been investing repair work, but some different fencing and stuff over the years, and I just thought we should list all the cemeteries that we're responsible for, because there is some capital potentially, since John is doing wants to do such a long-term plan.
Encompass everything.
We should encompass everything. So anyway.
Whether it gets done
When we get to the capital article, we'll talk about that. Article 8 is longevity pay. That's part of the compensation plan.
Mm-hmm. We saw the exchange about the overtime that the planning board, or the personnel board, was proposing to change our bylaw on overtime, and I said that I recommended against doing that at this point in time for a variety of reasons. But they did recommend that we do this. So I'm just handing out the minutes from their meeting.
Okay.
So they've recommended.
It can't be done at this town meeting.
You're saying it can't be done?
We did not have it on the public meeting.
That's something to look at.
I think we can look at it. We can look at it if we want to do it later on. We are going to have that special town. We're going to have a marijuana special town meeting.
Does that mean everybody brings their own?
No. Where were you? I was just talking about all that marijuana stuff. We don't have to rush.
I know, I heard.
I thought we, from the MMA article, it looked like we had to make all our decisions at this annual town meeting if we were going to make the April 1st, 2018 deadline for the state. And because you have to adopt a sales tax prior to receiving applications, and the applications were supposed to, right now the applications are proposed for April 1st, 2018. And they might, I'm sure they will kick it up because they haven't done any regulations, but it made it sound like it had to be this meeting. And I talked to Adam Costa, and he said, since we're postponing the zoning, since the planning board didn't act on the zoning,
we're going to have a special town meeting anyway.
We'll have to have a special town meeting on the zoning anyway. And then we can determine the number of pot shops at that point, which is, you know, you can do it. You can have a moratorium. We'll have a discussion. We can, because the choices are a moratorium, 20% of your liquor licenses, or less than your dispensary, which is zero. So it would be like one. So, we have that options. Those are how they are legally allowed to determine the number of shops in your town. So we will have to discuss the ramifications of all that. So I feel like we'll have more time to discuss it, and we'll sort it out over the summer.
You'll have to get on that.
And we'll have to get on that. But we'll, because I certainly did not want to miss the opportunity for sales tax.
Right.
You get a local sales tax of 2%. The state will still collect at 6.5, but we are allowed the local option of 2%, but that has to be adopted before you have the first permit application.
Right.
So if we do it in the fall, we'll be okay. Well, you know, that's what Adam said. So
it's my understanding, and maybe I'm wrong, but I thought that the legislature was looking at something other than 6.5%.
For themselves. For themselves, yes. Right now, they're going to adjust it, but
okay.
We have to adopt the local option of 2%. It's just like a room tax or something, the local option 2%.
Do we adopt more?
No. The 2% is the maximum. Don't worry, I've already complained about it. I said the 2% is not enough.
No.
But
still being assessed.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot. Right now, it's 2%. So that's another reason not to rush and adopt the 2%, because maybe we can get 4% out of it or something like that. Whatever.
Maybe we can get 2% on cigarettes, too.
Well, I feel like those vapor things are so nasty that we should get something. So anyway, whatever. We need to get Wendy home. She's had too many 12-hour days, and she worked the weekend.
You've got 42 minutes left before.
It's only 10 of 8.
I know.
Four more hours to go.
No, we have 12. No. We have 12 minutes before she starts. Article 9 is the omnibus budget, which is we're still working on with the Finance Committee. Article 10, this is the OPEB.
Yes, this is an article about creating a trust fund, which is now required and linked to the next article, which has to do with appropriating some money. And the Finance Committee did talk about that last night.
I thought we already opened an account. So this
we did something, but there's been some change, and this is what we need to do now. Barbara and Town Council went back and forth about this.
Well, you might as well clean it up because it has no money in it anyways.
It makes reference to that article of the 2015.
By the way, thank you for approving at least a deposit into the OPEB account.
Approving what?
A contribution.
OPEB?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I just to make it look like we're doing something. Okay.
So this is
okay. We will find out what the actual, because this is the year that Barbara has to have the auditors come up. We have to pay the extra money for them to come up with the estimated OPEB liability. Mm-hmm. You have to do this on a cycle every three years. So I didn't want to do it before because why pay for, we weren't funding it anyway. So why would you pay money to find out how much you really owe? So this will have more of a discussion impact for next budget year. But thank you for contributing, because I would guarantee it's at least $1 million by their estimates. Article 12 is this is a sewer treatment plant. But is that budget been worked on? I mean,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's done, right?
And
that's
just,
you're okay with the sewer treatment?
We have no idea what it is.
This is not
a
capital. This is just
what this is your operating budget?
This is the operating budget.
Well,
we did. We approved.
Yeah, you.
You approved it.
We recommended.
Right.
You recommended.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
So okay.
Okay.
Article 13 is the SCEMS.
Right. The motion this year, as recommended by the report that someone had done, is going to be more extensive with a whole list, and we'll have it printed out.
Great.
Detail.
Okay.
But this is the article. It's just.
Yep.
Okay. Article 14 is the capital projects one.
Okay.
And I guess we could just take a minute to look at what was submitted for this year.
Sure.
Did you guys have any questions on it?
I looked at it. I thought it was pretty good. Yeah.
Okay.
There are only about four items on it anyway.
No, it's not very much.
No, they've worked pretty hard at though.
Yes. Well, and like I said, John is organizing it.
Yeah.
So that we're going to actually have more of a long-term plan.
What's the number on that? There's not a number on that. I don't remember where I stuck it in my book.
I haven't seen it until today, and I got it today.
Well, it's the voting machine, the highway shed repair, salt shed repair, the elementary school. Well, I'll read them so that there's no question, because we were supposed to comment on them as part of the process before April 7th. So it's $6,500 for the new voting machine. Mm-hmm. The salt shed repair is $7,000.
And that seemed okay as far as we got a few bids back because we were thinking it might be higher, but
great. Kevin got a couple bids because it's not repairing, it's repairing around the door.
Just going around
stuff that's rotted.
Okay, good.
Elementary school, it was $6,500, and that is really that's for the hardware.
And I spoke to Kevin. I think that's going to be high, too. I mean, you know, it's not going to cost.
This is by the doorway.
You go
on both sides of the doorway, yeah.
Okay.
We're just going to put a small pipe in there.
So the entry foyer drainage is separate? The entry foyer drainage is $12,500?
No.
65.
It's 65.
It's here listed as 12.5. Mm-hmm. Mm. So that's a mistake?
I got it right on mine.
You know what? I was reading from the wrong line. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I will do what Kip did and line it up. Okay.
And you're lucky you still get to use your eyes.
Let me clarify. So for the elementary school, we have the entry foyer drainage at $6,500. Mm-hmm. The next item is door hardware repair, the door stuff hardware.
Start doing the
is $12,500.
Some interior, some exterior.
Yeah.
To get those.
The more priority ones. Mm-hmm. $17,000 to replace flooring.
Those last two are just first year of a three-year?
Correct.
Of 3 years, yes.
Yep.
It's in our projection of our plans. We just split them up by three, or the Capital Committee voted to split it up over 3 years. SCEMS from retained earnings is $108,000 for the ambulance. IV pumps is $21,000. Stretcher loaders should be is $50,000.
Yeah.
Facility outfitting
is nothing. Zero.
Well, they're going to take that from retained earnings, I think. How did you guys?
We
weren't able to vote on that because it didn't list anything specific.
Right.
For
okay.
A capital item.
Right.
So, but
they don't really know.
Remains with SCEMS for obviously the build out or furnishings or whatever, the 54 plus there.
And yeah. They'll come to
but it won't, but they'll have
later
to come, they're going to come with a specific listing
of what they need.
Yeah.
Later.
So we're not voting anything.
Carolyn, I got an email from John just this afternoon as far as that, and those $50,000 for stretchers. On the copy that I got, there was only $25,000 approved.
Yeah.
The Capital Improvement Committee only voted one.
Yeah.
But Finance and Select Board at our meeting over there, we voted to the two.
Yeah.
So that's what's going in the warrant. That's the requests. And like I said, in my paperwork here, I have the other. I just have to find it. I mean, I had it earlier. I was showing Wendy.
Yeah, what you're going to do.
Well, we'll find it at the end. Was the rest of the plan to 20 years? There's some speculation that we could do some a 20-year spread, but I think.
Comment, please.
Oh, the generator.
Yes.
That, oh, thank you. Yes.
Okay.
Actually, do you have enough copies to give it to Bruce, Jeff?
It's fairly.
We discussed it.
Oh, you discussed it already? You already had it?
We discussed it. It took us about 30 seconds, and we decided we didn't have enough information, so.
Oh.
The discussion ended.
So it was not purview until the FCC.
And the capital improvement committee hasn't looked at it either, so.
No.
I do have a question going back to capital.
Yes.
You said you're going to hold a public hearing?
Yes, next week is the public hearing, because you have to have the public hearing before the.
So we've advertised 2 weeks in advance?
No.
Not required?
It doesn't have to, I don't believe it's 2 weeks.
Just ask.
As long as we have to have the public hearing before the meeting.
I thought public hearings had a specific length of notice.
Well, the bylaw.
Well, it's bylaw-driven, not Mass General Laws driven.
So it hasn't been advertised in the newspaper?
No, we don't have time to do that. That's the flaw this year.
We are not. That's one of the things we're going to eliminate, because advertising in the newspaper, if it's on the website and we have a handouts, advertising in the newspaper, we're trying to eliminate that when we can. Because very few people actually get the newspaper, the Greenfield Recorder.
Public hearing for the capital improvement.
As long as we have the public hearing. Andy, I'm not trying to give you a hard time.
Not going to advertise public hearings.
If that, Carolyn, if that gets to be that question, I don't want to spend a lot of time on town meeting floor debating it, so I guess I'd make sure that gets run past council. And go over the decision.
Advertising
comes
the
to worse, we
capital
can,
plan. Okay.
Yep.
Hold the night of the public hearing, which you did last time. I mean, the annual town meeting, you held it before the annual town meeting. And we have time to advertise it now.
We can put it in the newspaper, I guess. It's just such an expense.
Chairman Council might not be required. I agree with Skip. I just don't want to be initial.
There's no sense in getting into a battle on town meeting floor if we can't resolve the town meeting floor. So let's resolve it beforehand.
It's complicated.
Well, then Lisa can say yes or no. Yeah. That's simple.
Well, Wendy, maybe we can make a motion. I mean, I know we were going to make a motion to eliminate it, but that'd be part of the.
Well, we actually have a warrant article to
eliminate it.
I
know.
I mean, I don't have the whole. It'll be in the motion, but capital plans.
I know.
Perfect.
And it's on this warrant to review the.
Just check with Lisa, even though it's our intention to eliminate it. Make sure that it is.
Yeah, this year we're under it still.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Make sure it's okay.
So the so we were talking about maybe wanting to add a generator or for this year or for next year.
We can submit this. This can come from the select board.
Correct.
Because we've been trying to sort this out for years, and it seems like we have a. If we break it down in 2 years, it wouldn't be too onerous. You could do the pad this year.
Just pour the pad and get it ready.
Yeah, and then we can put in the generator for next year.
You would talk to John, right, on what?
Well, I made sure Kip looked through this.
Yeah, you would talk
if we're going to put any more money into it, I want to absolutely make sure it's fixed.
Right, and I looked at that estimate that was on there, and I brought it to other electricians, and I was really waiting to hear back from Wayne.
Yeah, see what he thinks.
But I read that his. His statement is kind of vague, just that he looked into it. But
you mean, Wayne? Oh, that Kevin looked into it? Oh, Wayne signed. Okay.
Our wire inspector.
Okay. So maybe you would, can you connect with him?
Yeah, I'll connect with him again.
Before next week, because I don't want to add it.
Yep.
if this isn't gonna, yep. if you don't feel comfortable with it, then we can skip it for until next year. We'll put the whole thing on next year.
Put the pad down. I mean, we're gonna do one eventually, right?
Yeah. So you just go ahead and pad.
The pad for the student is not that big. No,
I see. Yeah. Okay.
It's probably like a $200.
Oh, really? I thought it was more money. I thought it was a couple thousand.
See why? Right.
You're talking a concrete pad that's 3 feet by 5 feet.
And then a feet deep.
So what the hell is the chart?
We did get an updated, but it's pretty similar to that estimate from Pachorik.
You did?
But then he was going to go back, take another look, and break it out. But I haven't seen that.
All right.
I don't know.
Was that in response to the Finance Committee questions?
I don't know what prompted that. I know that.
What were your guys' questions?
Well, there was no one to answer any questions.
No,
About what was needed?
About what was needed, what size, or anything else.
It wasn't up to you to make a decision.
And that should have gone through the capital improvement. So.
Yeah.
We weren't going to vote on it, but we didn't have any information either. Mm.
Well, I think the generator itself was going to be for next year's capital improvement.
Well, that's fine.
It was the pad we were going to do this year. We were going to pour the pad.
I think you should do it all at once because
you don't think it's worth it.
It doesn't. The concrete pad is what? A few $100?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And there's a real good likelihood, depending on where it was placed, you can put it right on the blacktop that's out there. I mean, these things are.
We're talking about putting it out here.
So I'm a little bit curious. Why would we need an 80 kW generator?
So they can run everything in this building simultaneously.
For emergency, I think.
But we don't.
Center?
The panel that we have now isn't 80 kW.
It's not.
So why the hell do we need a generator that exceeds the panel?
That's what I've been looking into.
But
the thing is, even when you when you wire a house, I'm not even sure of the formula, but you only really have to put in like for 80% of what you're going to use because everything doesn't run at once anyways.
No.
And that's the same thing here.
What we have is no heat on that side. And no
lights. Wait a minute. No, heat is not. There's no electric heat in here. So all we need to do is turn a motor on.
Well, there's no lights in here apparently.
I appreciate that. Well, all I'm saying is if you take a look at the panel or panels that we have now, and you add up all of those panels, they don't come anywhere near 80 kW.
Skip. This is why I gave it to Kip to sort this out because you know. From your years on the Finance Committee that we have been trying to sort this out for, I would say, at least 10 years. Don't you agree?
But what I think I'm hearing is they want to heat the building with electricity.
You need to heat it.
No.
You need to be able to heat the building and you need to cool the building, depending on when the emergency is. And we need power here to
have
lights.
Heating? Do we have cooling in here now?
We have air conditioning.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This
and we have heat here now.
Yes.
So what we need is the power to turn that heating system on.
Right. Yes.
And it doesn't seem like.
And some lights.
And we need lights here.
And obviously power for laptops.
If you look at 80 kW, that's
a big unit.
That's an awful lot of power. And we're not using that in here now.
Okay.
That's why I'm asking
Wayne. Wayne put down, we currently have an 80 kW generator. I could be wrong, but I looked at that thing and it doesn't look it's that big at all. But, you know.
Maybe 8.
Huh?
Maybe 8.
It's a typo? Oh?
Yeah.
He said it's an older.
I'm delegating this to you. This needs to be sorted out.
I'll take care of it.
Okay. Because you know what, I want to just get this done.
Yeah, well, I mean, we should
this
be
has
prepared
been like
if we need
least,
to have an issue.
Bruce,
if we have an
yes.
issue
yes, it was also stated in our meeting that it might be enclosed.
Out there, outside, it would have to be in an enclosure.
Well, no. It's going to be a self-contained unit.
Right.
Yeah.
That was my point.
Yeah. We don't have to
build a building.
No.
But I don't. I mean, I guess it could go in that room again. I just don't think that's very wise to put
gas.
It inside the building.
It's natural gas.
Yes.
The one that's in there is natural gas as well. But it's just, you know, if you get any exhaust leaks or anything in there, the CO detectors would go off.
The proposed loop is for diesel, then I believe.
No, natural gas.
It's a natural gas generator.
That one?
Yeah.
Well, I hope so, because we couldn't use natural gas unless
that's
we
the other issue that we're going to check out whether, right,
oh
the
my
moratorium
God.
Is.
No,
right.
It doesn't affect it because we have
that's
the service for that gas.
Yeah, I thought, so since we already have it.
We can, you don't even got to call the gas company. You just make the connection from there to the other one. The only
all
time
right.
you have to call the gas company is
this is not for this year.
Yeah.
Runs.
Good.
So we don't have anything to discuss next year because we've just
This is going to be on the selectmen's report for next year that we finally fix the generator. Or proposed fix for the generator will be happening.
Right before that.
I believe it was
by a dozen horses.
The tornado in Conway that prompted this discussion.
Yeah, it did.
Pop up again so late in the season.
We do like cruise ships. We'll just get a series of, what do you call those, bicycles, and then we have a disaster. We can all get on a bicycle, start pedaling it.
That's a good idea.
You know what? I'm just so. Yeah, I'll help you.
Out.
That's the most important thing to do. Let's keep going.
Yes.
Yeah, got to keep going.
All right. Okay.
Stabilization.
So stabilization. We agree with the finance committee. This will be our.
That's a capital stabilization, correct?
Right.
To
yeah.
Create it.
And then
and
fund
then
it.
Fund it.
And then to fund it.
Is capital stabilization too?
How much are we funding it with?
Oh, a few million.
Huh? 20 bucks?
200,000.
Okay. Gotcha.
Next item 17 is free cash for snow removal. Do we have any idea what the shortfall is on that yet?
Yeah. It's big.
Is it?
I imagine.
Over $100,000.
This year has been a mess.
Yeah.
Snow
and
ice.
Yeah. Is it the salt budget that's made the increase?
No, it's all. It's going to be personnel.
Number of storms. We can have Kevin give us some information.
We'll break out.
Yeah.
We had a couple of good storms. It just doesn't seem like the winter was that bad.
It doesn't seem like a normal winter.
No.
What's that toll amount going to be?
What?
What's that toll amount going to be on the snow and ice?
It's going from 83, I think it was.
We've not done yet, and we know it's at least $100,000.
At least 100?
Over?
Oh, you're asking for next year, you mean, what the amount's going to be?
Right, yeah.
I don't know if we have that, do we?
I think it was like 83.
I think you're right about that.
Well, oh.
The amount this budget is 83.
Okay.
Yes. That's our base.
That's correct.
85.
Yeah, 85.
85 last year, 85 this year. Yep.
Yeah.
Does the selectman's office receive many complaints about roads not being plowed or roads being slippery or things of that sort?
No, they call us direct.
Oh, I've never gotten a call.
Or Kevin.
Really?
No,
everybody calls you?
I hear from people call the highway department direct.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
Oh.
I think that's a good sign.
Stop that, Bruce.
They would call here if they weren't happy with the call.
I return every call. Next article is there is no budget item for the community preservation is this year because we pulled our
two or three two
requests
projects.
Okay.
Do they? Okay.
I haven't seen their report.
Are we going to cut that out of the budget this year?
No.
CPA funding.
No, because we still get matches. This is a good way to earn
free money.
We're getting money from the state.
And what? We put in the bank account and it just keeps growing and growing?
No, because we're going to use it for subsidized senior housing. Oh, we're going to get this done. With you on the board, we're putting you to work. Don't try to get out of it.
Kevin, can you look in the back? Subsidize the residents, give them a little tax relief.
Wouldn't it be prudent
3%.
to
we
put
need to
that,
get focused on the articles, guys.
But wouldn't it be prudent to ask the taxpayers if they want to do
we
it?
We
did.
For
we
you?
Did.
We did.
Last meeting, we did.
And they said they wanted to keep paying?
No, they said they wanted it the first time. And
As long as we're getting the match, it's a wonderful way to get money from the state to do stuff and invest in our community.
Hey, if everybody wants it, I don't care.
Well, we're doing about 50% now.
Yeah,
we're
well,
not getting 100% match. It's about 50%.
They have, the state has on the rounds, the different amounts each round, and right. The state is making sure that they are funding the rounds. And as long as we keep it up to 3%, we get the third round. And it does add up. It makes a difference. So Article 19 is Smith. We don't have anybody, right?
No, but,
but we
do we
just
have
it there
though?
In case.
We thought it would be prudent. I talked to council, and Brenda and I talked that to just leave it on. We either
bypass it or
pass over. We have something there. Because sometimes you hear in June.
Pops up.
Like
yeah, absolutely.
We have one student now in their graduate.
So... So if we vote this, does this mean, if we pass it over, does that mean that we,
is that going to mess
us up?
There are two, 5,000 for transportation, 5,000 for tuition. The tuition certainly wouldn't be enough for one person, but, you know, we can do something afterwards. Or you can, if you get, you don't want it there, we don't really care. Up to you.
We will keep it just in case.
I feel like we should fund. Can we lower it down to 1,000 and keep it?
That's
is that?
Yeah.
It would if we just added kept 1,000 in case we ended up with a student.
And what will that do?
The 1,000. What would do is we didn't have to go back to town meeting. We could come to the finance committee for a reserve transfer.
It might be $20,000.
If there's a kid that goes down there. We don't have any choice. We're going to pay for it anyways.
Right. So it would be reserve transfer if we...
I'm not sure.
One way or the other. If we.
It is unforeseen.
It is an unforeseen expense. So the idea would be to put $1,000 in there, but why tie up $10,000? That's not enough anyway, either.
I don't care.
I would just rather just do $1,000 so we don't have to have this...
change it at town meeting.
Yeah.
You got 5,000 in there. If you want to, when you read the article, you want to change it to 1,000. Change it to 1,000.
Make a motion.
You think it's worth tying up 5,000?
Pardon?
You think it's worth tying up 5,000?
I don't. No, it's not. It's
because we're becoming.
We've got a budget of $15 million. 1% of that's 150,000. So 0.1% is 15,000. It's not worth discussing. It's so small. In relationship to the total budget, that it's, you know, it doesn't matter. Literally, think about that. It's just, it really is such a small amount that whether it's 1,000 or 5,000.
So you recommended 5,000?
Mm-hmm.
10, I think 5 for tuition. 5
and 5.
5
for transportation. 5 for transportation, 5 for tuition.
Let's leave it there because if we do have a student.
Pick up between now and.
Because if we end up with a student, it's less of a transfer from you.
Okay, right. Whatever.
Yep.
All right, we'll just leave it then. Article 20 is reserve fund for an.
That's $80,000.
$80,000, right? Yep.
You don't want to go higher. You don't want to go up to 100.
Well, you can put an extra 10,000 if you want to put it in there. Then you have your money for the.
Well, the only reason is that. You know, we budget every year, Skip, so close, and I just worry that there'll be something unforeseen, like a storm, okay?
Mosquito outbreak.
Actually, this is a very wet spring, and I only budgeted, I budgeted no money for lava siding, okay?
For what?
For lava siding. That $11,000 is for trapping, and we're getting another year free from the state for testing.
That was a bounty fund.
What? Yeah. I didn't hear you. What?
Better.
Bounty fund.
Yeah. Okay. So anyway, the state is testing us for free. So, but if this is a really wet spring, this is so different from last year already. So if we actually get hits of stuff, people will want us to lava side, and there's no money for lava siding.
If you want to put it in, then we can talk about it. that'd be the recommend.
Well, would you
meeting next Tuesday, so.
Would you think about it? Would you think about going up to 100? Would you have consensus of 100?
That's fine. In a reserve fund?
Yes.
In the reserve.
Because we've had the same amount every year.
And we always run out?
No, we.
Well, then why change it?
Because we, one storm could change it.
It's Russian roulette.
Well,
if we haven't spent it, I mean, you got to kind of go with that history.
Well, we spent 60 or so thousand.
A couple of years ago, we voted to establish that the winter storm fund, whatever. That legislation allows the town to deficit spend.
I know it does.
So what we can do is at the annual town meeting in April, you can vote, and I think that's what you're talking about doing now, to pay off that overage or the overspending.
I guess we could.
And we can do that for basically.
Do you think would that cover debris removal? Because you know one of the big expenses in Conway is debris removal.
You have to talk with Kevin on that. I don't know.
See, I mean that. I feel like the state has you. You're not.
Did the state help at all with that, coming up and chipping that stuff? Or?
And if that's the case, $20,000 isn't going to go very far. He's already eaten up all of the reserve at this point, and then some. So. Yeah.
Well, if you declare a state of emergency, you can get permission to deficit spend.
Yeah, no, so. I mean, you can justify a higher amount in the reserve, but, you know, we just didn't discuss it.
Right.
If you want to recommend $100,000, then next Tuesday we'll take a look at it and,
Well, the reason why, Skip, is because every year we cut and cut and we're asking people to be, the department heads to be as frugal as possible. So we've really, I mean, there's not a lot of squish room anywhere in the budget. And I would rather have you have a little bit of ability if something happens. I mean, all we have to have is a couple, blowouts in the sewer and stuff, things like that.
And 20,000 isn't going to do anything. The 80,000 isn't going to do anything. So it's
all right.
Just good.
All right, never mind. Never mind.
Put it at 100,000 in, and we'll talk about it.
We'll talk about it Tuesday.
Okay, please talk about it because I
don't think it's a problem.
All right. Article 21.
That's the land.
Oh, okay.
Voted when you accepted the property, you voted to accept it for highway and recreational. And so we are
changed.
Asking that it be for general municipal purposes, which would allow
us to build the EMS. Okay.
Did you talk with Lisa about that? Because
she wrote the article. Yes.
I spoke with her quite a bit about this last summer, and it was not a big deal.
Oh, it isn't a big deal.
You didn't even have to do this because there was no restrictions on it. I don't know why she changed it.
I guess, I don't know, looking at the article from the 2003 annual town meeting, specified that it be for highway department facilities. She thought differently. I don't know.
Well, I spoke to her, and if I get to see through the cobwebs, what seems to happen frequently in town is that things might be voted or things are done that, but they're not carried through to finish. And there was no restrictions put on the deed. And that's really what you go by.
No, what? Not when you vote to do something a certain way. This is just
I don't know.
It really is not a big deal. It's simply to allow us to use it for any use.
Perfect.
It just clarifies it's not restriction.
Moving on.
Well, for instance, 22. The article that the schools gave us for the special, and then withdrew the Sunday and had their meeting and didn't pass it, years ago, I don't have 10, how many years ago, you designated money for the school administration for fixing the building.
Right.
They
didn't use it all.
It, but they've had it for years. I don't know what they used to. Anyway, they asked you for permission to revote that, to use it.
To move over.
So that is an example of that kind of thing.
have a restricted use. Now, I was just wondering, we gave it to them. It's in their control, but they, you know, still because of the use that we put on it, in the language of the, you know, the three towns, the four towns, they came back and asked for that. I don't know what they did, because we never voted on anything. So. But that's just another reason.
The Article 22 is leasing the property to Deerfield. Yes.
Are we going to put a dollar amount in that article?
For the lease?
A dollar?
No, this is, they're talking about the...
Yeah, leasing it.
We're going to charge skins, is that correct? Are you authorizing the select board to lease it without a dollar value?
We agreed at $30,000. Is that all right?
Well, we can mail that
$36,000.
That's what I thought you were talking about last
week. $36,000?
Is that right?
Yeah. I think, yeah.
Yep. Let's get clarity.
And I think the money needs to be, if, at least you have to be able to talk about where that money, what that money is going to be used for when it comes back in the town conference. How
this is different, though. Isn't this a different thing?
Is it 50% maintenance? 50%?
I think this allows, verify with Lisa that this just allows us to lease the property.
Right.
Rent, and where that goes, that has to be discussed.
Okay.
We don't have a definitive number. So I think this just gives us the ability to lease the building to the South County.
I feel pretty obligated to the dollar amount that I kept talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I think we all agree there has to be some kind of maintenance and capital improvement cost kind of thing.
Right, I think all towns
have to negotiate this. If you tie it here at town meeting.
Yeah.
So it's going to have to be another town meeting article that can approve, each town have to approve a lease agreement?
Probably.
I think they would.
Probably, yeah. I mean, the other two towns would have to vote because they pay, you know, they charge rent right now. Mm-hmm. We all charge rent.
Right.
Or pay rent. So now we...
Well, what's wrong with having you pay rent? I mean, I understand the difference between rent and the lease, but, you know, is there a problem with that?
I thought this was the lease. That's the difference.
If it's simpler to rent it, that's...
No, this is the lease for, to lease it to the, they have the ability to lease it to Skins. Yeah.
Anybody?
Sure with that?
Yeah.
It's allowed you to lease it there.
This is for the purposes of providing housing for the regional.
Right. Okay.
This is for us to really.
To release the land or
that's once the land, the building is built.
Does it make any difference?
How are we supposed to transfer the property in the meantime?
I think we're talking about a parcel of land. It might have a building on it. Are we going to lease just the property to Skins?
No.
Or are we going to
lease the building.
The building also?
Just the building.
Just the building.
So
we're going to give them right away?
Trevor actually has a good question on this. Here we're changing the purpose of the land. Shouldn't we have an article in here allowing us to lease the property to Deerfield Academy to build the building?
That's what I thought that was.
Well, that's what I thought
that's
the previous
thought
one was.
No, that's a change of use. That's a change of use. Article 21 is...
Yeah, we had an entry. That was the thing. We had that entry.
So, because you changed the use, then you leased to the Deerfield Academy, and then they give us the building, and then we have... Then we get permission to lease the building.
I think the first one, Article 22, is to lease it to DA.
Okay.
We'll figure that stuff out. With Lisa.
Well, we have to sign this tonight, so or meet Friday. I posted a meeting in the event something came up. And
you did post a meeting for Friday?
I did.
Okay.
3:30.
All right.
Or we can sign this, and I'll talk to her.
And if you need
tomorrow.
Us to re-sign something
I'll
on Friday, we can.
I'll have to sign it because I have both granddaughters on that day. I'm babysitting at 3:30. But it's okay. I mean, I'll just bring them down.
Bring them down.
I'll bring them down.
I'll bring lollipops.
I got to play with.
All right. Yeah, I remember this writer country thing.
I think
it wasn't discussed in this round.
Okay. Let's just leave a question. And do we need to stick in another article, like a transition article where we lease it to DA and then we? Because this, I mean, I think we do need permission to lease.
I don't think it was leasing.
Then it would make sense that we have to still have permission to lease it to South County, right? Or is that?
But that could be next.
That could be after.
That could be next year.
They just authorized to lease, period.
Right. To anybody. That's what I think our 22 is for.
But. I mean, that could be verified.
I think you're right. I think that covers the basics.
Oh, really? Okay.
I do, but
I'm pretty sure.
I'll verify.
We'll verify.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, I think it's too specific right now.
Okay.
Okay.
What's too specific?
The article.
The article.
Providing housing for regional emergency medical services.
May not need to be that specific right now.
That we can lease it to DA, and then we can lease it. What we're asking for is permission to lease it to DA to build the building, and then lease it to,
do we have to put,
South
like
County, if we just say we have the ability to lease it.
Right.
That's all we should have to say.
We'll check.
And that would address both of them?
Yeah.
Well, we'll check with Lisa.
Okay, we voted to increase the amount for legal counsel, so.
Okay. Thank you.
Maybe you use legal counsel.
Maybe we could hire a part-time planner lawyer.
Don't worry, my 20 minutes on the phone with Adam Costa is already charged against the marijuana tax. I told him to hold off billing us until we get the marijuana money. Okay.
And you have 1 minute to finish up.
I know.
Yes.
We have to take care of Wendy. So.
No.
I know, but this is not really fair to keep you up.
Too late.
It's 1,000 o'clock.
So.
And then the Article 23 is our church article.
Yep. We're good with that.
Article 24 is special legislation
to fix our
natural bank.
Correcting the procurement issue.
Perfect.
If the governor's
if he doesn't come around to signing. Okay.
They contacted me today. First of all, I mentioned to the finance team, I was very happy to hear from Mark Abramson, the commercial and industrial realtor, because he's working with them, so that gave me confidence. And then they called today looking for the amendment. I said I sent it to council, sent it to your council. So
we're getting there.
Yeah.
So you haven't heard anything from the governor? I don't understand.
Well,
this was supposed to be a quick fix.
He's supposed to be in Greenfield tomorrow at the opening of the courthouse, so I'm playing with.
What time is that?
It's at 2 o'clock.
Can you go up and say what the heck? This is the economic development thing.
He probably has no idea. It's his staff that does it. It's Steve Kulik that we're asking to kind of monitor.
All right. Well,
so
chase him down.
Article 25.
So if we do Article 24, that means we don't have to have the governor sign. It's done.
No.
If it happens before town meeting, we will pass over this. If it doesn't, we will want to do this.
Okay.
It was my impression that this had to come no matter what.
I think that
what you said to us.
Some reason I had gotten the impression, and I will clarify that with Lisa, that we didn't with the governor doing it, the legislature.
So if the governor
Need town meeting approval.
Okay.
Well,
I don't know.
You know, I will clarify that too. But that was what Steve Kulik told us when we first contacted him.
Right.
Our options for correcting.
So with this article, it still requires the House and Senate to make the vote.
And the governor
has to go through legislation.
Then the governor will sign.
Yes, I think he will.
Or override it.
And Article 25 is another one of those.
But this is the kind of thing is a fast. He did tell us our options were to have to work through the governor's office for this technical kind of thing. The second was to do a fast action one with Deerfield, but I think that period of time has elapsed because of the budget calendar. So at any rate, it will happen.
And Article 25 is a Municipal Modernization Act?
Yeah.
Okay.
It allows us to have contracts
instead
for
of
up
3 years.
To 5 years instead of three and $10,000.
Okay.
Was the next one. Okay.
No, so the next one is to allow the assessors to have the 5 years instead of 3 years, right?
So they can do their contract for the quinquennial.
Article 27 is the
American Way.
It's the Fix American Way mess.
Because we never did do that, right?
We never voted on that.
Okay,
right?
Good. So, yep.
Article 28 is.
We never had the meeting last year.
We never had a special town meeting.
It appears like we voted on it, right? But I guess we just.
I thought we voted on annual town meeting.
This is.
I thought we did too, but I couldn't find it.
Question whether it met all the town standards.
Yeah, I.
Which it doesn't.
But that's part of the problem is they changed the layout or the lot line.
Doesn't have a cul-de-sac. Doesn't meet subdivision standards, so you can't accept it until it meets subdivision standards.
Well, that was what the Board of Selectmen did. They took it. They took the power away.
The Board of Selectmen had control of the whole project, and Planning Board had nothing to do with it.
Right.
But now they're going to go and create a public way, and the only regulations that exist are in the Planning Board, subdivision control. And he's turn around. If you know more than 800 feet,
you can go around the highway garage.
Yeah, but I think it's a limit on distance too, without a waiver. I'm going to open up a can of worms.
Yeah, but it was a special district.
Go fishing.
I don't know. I'm just asking.
But the special district allows us to do this, Bruce.
Okay.
Well, it allows you to be the permitting process,
right.
But you still have to follow some sort of rules. And the only rules that exist in the town are the site plan review and subdivision laws.
We got a grant to walk us through this,
mm-hmm.
and everything was done according to, you know, the
40D.
Yes. Whatever that development was.
Expedited
permitting.
Yeah.
So just get Lisa to double check, but I think it is okay. We just didn't vote to accept it.
I know what I.
We kept. Yeah, and I think that's why we didn't vote to accept it.
Because the line wasn't right or something, right? They had to extend in to give access to that.
Yeah, the property line was included the building for one thing.
Right.
Yeah, and so we got that fixed.
It needed a new survey to define it, plus it needed physical improvements to make so it could meet subdivision regulations in the town. Now you're going to subdivide off of it to sell to New England Natural Bakers, and they're going to use that road for frontage. So it has to be subdivision, I believe. But I'm not sure. I'm just bringing the point out that something should look at it.
I think, can you just check on the expedited permitting? I do not believe there's frontage requirements. But just check with Lisa, okay? It was laid out under the grant to meet all the requirements.
And why do we have to accept it as a public board?
Because that's the process. You have to make it a town road. It has to be accepted. And that I think that's why we keep
running into a brick wall.
Yes. Every time we bring it to town meeting, there's a question that we don't have answers for. And so just make sure that, Bruce, that all your questions get to Wendy so that we can get legal advice on them and have answers for them so we can finally vote this and finally sell the property. Because this is like huge problems. I mean, spring is here. They need to start. Article 28. This is Barbara's request for tax bills under $100. That's not a problem.
What are we doing with tax bills under $100?
Yeah.
Single request, as opposed to?
Twice a year.
No, instead of sending out a second bill, they have to pay everything up front.
Some Bruce Hunter or something?
Yeah, 45, 50 times.
I know.
And you have, that includes personal property taxes.
Yeah, I know.
Right now they have a
it's
50.
It's not just real estate.
They have a $50 one-time fee.
So if you have a little...
The new legislation allows a $100 fee, but you have to accept that.
So personal property.
It includes personal and real property. There is some very small parcels that do have very minimal tax base. Hmm.
We are making sure that everyone is taxed. Article 29 is purchasing, striking Chapter 39.
It's overridden by the statutory bid laws.
Okay. 30 is building construction.
Variety of things that Dick had.
Dick had, okay. This is from the fall town meeting?
Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
Fall town, we know fall town.
We didn't
That's
have
why it. It's here.
That's why here, because we didn't fix it.
Who's going to be?
31 is the Capital Improvements Committee's...
changes of the bylaw.
Changes of the bylaw.
32 is the single-payer resolution that she just spoke
about. Holy smoke. Who's going to read that?
I'll read it.
Thank you.
And 33 is just our normal instructions to officials. Okay.
And you think we'll get this all done in one night? Go ahead, Bruce. Right.
Bruce, we're going to make sure you don't come.
Bruce, can we get all this done in one night?
Well, I have to sit up front this year, so I don't have to get a time to find.
Just if you have any questions on this, seriously, so no, we don't hold up town meeting, would you please let Wendy know so we can verify things through
that? I think Wendy's has to be looked at relative. Who has the authority to declare it as a public way?
Yep.
The town does, but does that meet the standards? That's all.
There was one question I'm not sure I got. It was between that one, somewhere in the mid-20s. After the question about whether we need another article for leasing to...
He just introduces the article.
Oh, other than that one?
Yeah, I was writing it.
Let's see.
That's what I'm saying. He reads the article. And we read the motion.
An abbreviated portion of them. Yeah.
No, actually, I think your practice has been to dispense with the reading of the articles and just go to the motions.
Well, what he does is he says he has an introduction.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So he doesn't read the whole thing. Like this will be an introduction. He'll say something like,
that's a long.
For example, any planning board articles that run 15 pages, he doesn't have to read the whole thing.
No. But, he does some kind of introduction, and then we have the motion. Okay. We read the motion. Yes, Bruce.
I noticed that the single-payer health insurance resolution is on there, but there's a reason why that David White's resolution request is not approved.
He did not submit one. So he is going to
catch all
on the Article 33. He's going to present.
He's 33.
Yes. So
there's no money attached to that.
No. I mean, he's going to suggest. My understanding, he's going to suggest a CPA money to purchase the property down there, but it's a resolution. It's not a warrant article.
So what the resolution, what does it carry? What weight does it carry?
It's, well, if town meeting supports it, it means that there is support in town for the purchase of that property with CPA money. So, I'm not sure what our recourse is or what the procedure would be, but I'm not going to anticipate what the...
Oh,
yeah, I mean, I'm not going to...
anything about Dave, purchasing this property with CPA money. Where did that come from? That wasn't even stated.
Well, he was talking about the having a senior housing, subsidized senior housing be built here, and we move the ball fields down there, and town use a purchase.
You read a lot into that.
He's been in here numerous times.
Okay. Yes, he's been talking about it. And
in the last article, the instruction can be a resolution?
Yeah.
I mean, he can, people come up and do anything.
Well, I know what they can
Bruce,
say.
Bruce, you've been to enough meetings that they tell you anything.
But if it's not on the warrant as a resolution, how can, the catch-all is just instructions to the select.
Right. It's instructions to officers.
The officers.
Right, and they make the decision.
And the officers have their choice as to what they do with it.
Right.
I take to heart everybody's, suggestion or criticism or instructions. I make a serious effort to try to, follow through if it's a town meeting request. But number one, we don't have a request. Okay,
I'm not going to. Last year to look at reorganization of town government.
That was not under that article.
Actually an article.
It was an article. Yes.
I asked about that. It still exists. We didn't need to revote it. You could still undertake that action without revoting it. It stands. It continues to stand as an opportunity for the moderator.
My concern is that passing this over as a resolution, maybe it's his best option.
Well, the warrant is closed and it's printed.
Well, you agreed to accept one tonight, so.
That was already submitted, and we didn't. It was submitted by the deadline. It was submitted.
I just don't want the town committee any money at all for a study, traffic or hydrological study for any property in town.
Ever?
I don't think there's a need for it. If a person owns a property, wants to do something with it, they need to perform that study.
Right.
The town does not need to be doing studies on private property.
Correct.
Nor my property, or anybody else's.
And when you talk about CPA money, doesn't that have a process that has to work through?
Mm-hmm.
How can
sure.
you just automatically bring it to the town floor? I thought there was a process set up.
Sure.
Jeff.
Yeah.
Jeff.
He's requesting.
He's requesting it, and it's instructions to officers. We don't even have the request. So you're asking us to give you what we're going to do on something that we don't have yet, okay? And we don't even know if we're going to have it. We don't know what the town meeting is going to say. And we're not going to discuss it anymore because Wendy needs to go home.
But we don't vote on recommendations. The town meeting does not vote on anything said in Article 33.
Well, yes, they.
No, the town meeting does. That's just what I said, Bruce. I said when people get up and they give instructions, there's indication at town meeting that people vote on what the instructions are.
I think like you could stand up and say I would want nobody the town should take no action to spend any money to do hydraulic tests on that kind of thing. And then you get the pulse of the room and see, what kind of.
I didn't realize it was a vote, and I didn't.
Yeah.
And the idea is, I've always, like I said.
Oh, I understand. It's
try to follow through on what people are really concerned about. I mean, and if a town, it's a town, not a formal town, it has no binding authority. Okay, it's not like we're voting it as a warrant article. It did not. No one submitted a petition or a warrant for the warrant before it was closed.
And it usually identifies the board, so it would be to ask the selectmen to do blah, 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 blah.
And then the town people vote on it.
And they vote, and then the selectmen, it's just an instruction to them to take a look at something.
I would assume that it would actually be a request to the planning board, not to the board of selectmen, because it's too. It's instruction to officers, boards, committees, commissioners, or any. So it would be an instruction by the town meeting vote, to the planning board. I mean, it wouldn't be proper to do the select board because select board isn't normally the reviewing person or board. So, but you're asking.
No, I'm fine.
Okay. Okay. Wendy?
The only other thing I had is just a little announcement about tomorrow from noon, from 10 to noon. I don't completely understand this, but I believe the chief and the and DPW superintendent were involved with this. They're doing a road safety audit related to Route 5 Elm Street. And they'll be meeting here, and it involves MassDOT officials and our own officials and engineers.
Are you going to be able to come go to that?
No, I'm going to be meeting with someone about the sewer plant and the Cavalier pump station.
Don't wear a tie.
But I have a split personality, so I guess I could attend both.
This is just informational, letting you know about this, and I let department heads, people in the building know, because they'll be.
So is this related to?
I guess it is.
Yeah.
Cumberland Farms.
Yes, it is. And in fact, I believe, for that reason, John will not be participating, but someone else.
From the department will definitely be there. Okay. And Kevin will be there.
I believe so.
Okay.
I cannot. I'll be out of town.
No, I'm not invited.
What's that?
I think they have an invited group.
Okay, good.
It's not.
Great.
Okay.
You don't have to.
It's good. It's a good thing.
I'm not. I'm going to meet you.
So, you'll find out about public.
Yes. A bunch of these things. So, I would like to be here. And if there is a problem, we have a meeting scheduled.
Yeah.
For Friday at 3:30.
Let's do that then.
These are seven. I hope it's on the wall. We've got to post five. I don't know. I think we should have backup copies.
I will try to follow up with John Taylor for the. Make sure I wrote that down. The correct date, the 12th and the 13th, right? Severance.
Yes, 12th and 13th.
So yep. We need to reserve this space. What day are we
going to? It's a Monday and a Tuesday.
In June.
I'll be
at a FEMA.
Okay. It's 12 and 13. So. Thank you, Pat. I'd appreciate that. As soon as I get confirmation from John, we can put it up on the website. And if you could, the contact list for EDS, you could send out, heads up, save the date. Yes.
It's should we have the dates? Are they nailed down?
No. Okay. I'm going to call John Taylor. He said to let him know. I talked to him after the REPC meeting. So he's very nice. He's had a lot of experience. And he's a good teacher. So I think he would actually enjoy it.
What's that?
The ICS training.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
It's a command system. That's the one I tried to get you to go to the show.
Well, you're kind of mandatory to do it.
As a chief elected official.
Don't worry. There's 200. I took 200, public health 200, and ICS 200, and I did the 300 course. I have not done the 400 course because it's a 4-day course. Every number you go up, it jumps up whole days. So I haven't been able to get four contiguous days when they have the training to do the 400, but I will get the 400 done.
Description.
That's one of those things that's mandated. It's mandated.
Definitely not in my salary scale either. I might like it.
No, I think you will. You'll be 100% committed to it. It works. It works. It works. I'm not kidding. It really works, guys.
I'm excited.
I would really like you guys to come.
I'm not sure what you're talking about, but
Incident Command System 100.
You're 100% committed to something that you like.
No, it's a ask Wendy. Wendy, what level are you trained to? You took the 400? Okay. See, I'm really impressed. She's,
well, if it's a disaster, I'll call you.
So what's this for?
This is basic incident command system, which is the uniform system of running disasters. As the chief elected officials, they have the responsibility to be in charge of that and work with
and police.
George Bush in 2000.
It's actually very interesting.
The Board of Selectmen has a lot of experience running disasters, too.
Hey, now.
George Bush.
We resemble that remark.
George Bush. That went right over my head, Skip. George Bush mandated that everyone that has a position of authority have the training. So you guys, you have positions of authority. You need to come.
I have no authority. The only authority we have is to recommend or not recommend.
That's an authority.
It's not authority.
But you can, actually, you should come and so you'd be trained as a volunteer, because if we have a really serious disaster, you would be on our list to volunteer. You'll be running the shelter here, and just hope that in a hot summer day that there's air conditioning is running, and in a cold winter day that the heat is on. Okay, right? That's why we're getting the generator, because you're going to be manning the shelter.
We had to do it in the schools, so we had to do it.
Schools are... Pat, thank you, by the way, for sending the square footage from Bob Lesko. I just filled out the MEMA thing for Frontier, and we do have the elementary school.
How many square feet do we have in Frontier?
What was in your email? It was so many emails ago, I forgot.
It was 64,000 square feet at the elementary school. I know that.
She sent me the email. Yes, but they don't have a generator that handles the whole school. It's we're regulated to the gym area. She sent me the square footage.
Oh, don't waste your time. Look it up on my account.
What's that?
The square footage for the as a shelter at Frontier.
Oh.
It has limited generator capacity. It has limited generator capacity.
How many people would really go to them?
Your most vulnerable population's in a real incident, but
everybody in the condos, the over 55, will be up here for.
Anyway, if there's no further business, I'll take.
Make a motion to adjourn. Oh, one more question,
yes.
Bruce.
Carolyn, I heard you mention something about a backhoe and $1,000 a day. You
well,
reference my name.
You remember you had asked me what it would cost to do the ditches, I was up front to clean out the ditches on Bloody Brook,
yeah.
And because
it
one of the
reasons would do it anyway. So I don't
what?
Know if I would have said that.
Pardon me.
A backhoe probably would not clean out the ditches.
No, they have those little. Yeah, those little things. Anyway.
So $1,000 a day, I don't know if I said that.
No, no, you didn't.
No.
You said my name.
Oh, no,
I said in reference
you
had asked the question
how much,
and I was trying to get quotes.
Great.
And so what
thank
I did
much.
Is I called around, and people are saying, well, you know,
just
2,000,
remember.
It wouldn't be any more than 2,000 a day.
And an operator is prevailing wage rate.
Mm-hmm.
Pardon me?
If it has an operator, you have to pay for beyond the wage.
Correct.
Right. Oh, no, yeah. I know that.
Unless he's one of our employees. Right?
No,
can't
it can't be. It can't be because
I
the whole...
I learned that too. We can't do it ourselves.
We can't...
The other thing is that you only incorporated a backhoe. If you're going to have a dredge, you're going to have trucking in there,
right.
And everything else. So that $2,000 a day is probably even still one.
Kip just said
that for a backhoe.
That was a backhoe.
The backhoe is... if they. I was given $2,000 a day, and that is for the person to do it
with I did hear that.
The smaller one and hauling it away and everything else.
Yeah,
I mean,
but
this
that's
is,
what I'm saying. What Henry quoted was only for the backhoe, so that
$1,000,
right. You've got to incorporate the trucking.
But Bruce had asked me how much the backhoe
right.
was, and so I was trying to get...
Oh, strictly the backhoe, yeah. Okay.
Yes, and I'm like, I don't know what those little things are. So, anyway, I wasn't, Bruce, you had a good question, and I didn't know, because all I said, it was going to cost, it wasn't going to be under your normal expense, but once it was done, the maintenance would be would be relatively inexpensive because it, we have 20 years worth of not maintaining the ditches.
I'm sorry.
When are we going to talk about the budget?
When we get the finished budget, I guess, from them, because we haven't, I mean, it's normally our budget, but we didn't, we haven't done anything on our budget.
Oh, I know.
They put the money into the OPEB.
Yep.
That was what else do you have left?
The only thing we have left are, I don't know what we have left. We basically finished everything last night except for a couple of minor items that, and I don't even remember what they were, but it wasn't,
Did you decide the energy budget? Because we were,
we did. Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't think, did we do anything with the,
did you vote the energy budget?
Yes.
Okay, so that was one of the things.
Oh, we didn't have the dollar amount for the overrun of the winter storm.
That was,
right.
But that's going to be.
But I'm not sure that, other than that, I don't think there's anything else.
What I was going to do, because we were not, we were going to schedule next week. I wasn't sure if Trevor could make it or not.
Oh,
I thought
we didn't.
We could go over what they've done.
We're going to talk about
and
salary.
If we have any questions, we can.
We need to get to that.
That's fine.
Because we need to prepare for the next
right.
week.
Article 9 says it.
And so, finally, we.
But did you want to get to, I mean, but Trevor's not going to be here next Wednesday. Or you
maybe
are.
Not. But
that's all right.
It was, you, as far as everything that's in the book is what we're going to do. Because they haven't really changed.
Right.
Other than the mosquitoes.
Right.
And I've already
I may be able to get back by then. Because my meeting's at noon in Boston with the doctor, so I should probably be back by, I'll be back by the evening. Unless my wife wants to stay in Boston and get a dinner or something.
6:30 is the joint meeting, unless we find a council then that doesn't meet the bottom of the line.
Okay. Oh, for Friday, you're thinking? I'm sorry, I missed part of that. I was thinking of a dinner in Boston, so.
Yeah, if we have a problem, if we need to add another article.
That's fine.
Yes.
I can. Okay.
Turns out there's a problem with the capital thing in the bylaw, which could be.
Mm-hmm.
Then, if the meeting next Wednesday, that's a joint meeting with capital planning, doesn't suffice to meet the bylaw, then that means nothing. Correct? No point in it happening if it's not going to suffice to meet the bylaw.
Well, I think you can ask Lisa. That
how to make I'm going to ask her how to make this work.
Yes. And
so
if we have to, we can vote on Friday to post, you can post the stuff tomorrow, really. I mean, we'll give you the authority to publish it.
Well, if the hearing stays on that date, it isn't enough time to put it in the newspaper. I'll straighten it off. I'll be back.
Okay.
Because
it's a newspaper
thing. Next Wednesday, jointly with the Capital Planning Committee, if that isn't enough, that doesn't suffice to meet the needs of the bylaw to do the whole capital plan thing correctly, then you will just be
do our
budget.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And if we have issues and we need to add an article, for instance, for the recent to DA, or whatever are the questions that came up, then we'll be Friday to meet.
Okay. That
it's
sounds
already
good.
Posted. All of those are posted and they can be canceled.
All right.
Thank you so much for all your work. You've
yes.
been working so hard, Wendy.
Wendy,
I got to tell you, and Pat, you've all been doing a lot in that department, and
I have to tell you,
everybody
in
town has been working super hard this year.
Yeah, it's been, I have to say, it's been great collaborating with everybody, and they appreciate it. I said, wow, I haven't seen this.
Learned a lot, I'll tell you
that. Let's, what do you think? What do you want? You know, what's wrong? Tell me.
Right.
Well, believe it or not, there's an awful lot of stuff going on in town.
It's amazing
and out of
how
town
much.
And,
as long as everybody works together.
That's right.
That's the only way to do it.
And Bruce, thank you so much for calling me this morning, because everyone forgot about the hearing. Not a single person in town.
Bruce brought up last year.
He did, yeah.
He did.
I don't.
But not a single person.
Nobody brought it up this year.
Yeah, I mean, Brenda said, oh my gosh.
You're a week late, Bruce.
Remembered it after you said it. I yelled at Pat. I said, Pat, how come you didn't remember it from last year?
Everybody else remembers it, believe me.
They remember it after you. Yes, but Bruce, they remembered it after you said it. And we said, well, why didn't you remember? But no one remembered.
I do have a 5-year plan.
Right.
Good for 5 years.
If that works.
I do have a question.
What?
Last year at annual town meeting, I don't know who put together a pamphlet that was passed out at town meeting that had the actual wording in there and procedure for town meeting. I thought that was a great little book. Is there any chance of having that same thing this year?
I think what we're going to do is once we decide on the motions that we can hand that out.
Yeah, I thought that was
but
a fantastic.
The only thing that is a problem is that, you know, because we need so many, it gets printed up, and if we change the motion, then people get mad. But
this is the kind of thing we'd like to put on the website. We don't get everything on the website. So,
well, no, it's what he's saying is there was a handout at town meeting,
right.
So you got everybody got to follow along, and
right.
It was a much
right because otherwise you get the warrant, which is a generalization,
right?
Go,
and I understand it may get changed, but you know the majority of warrant of articles will not be changed.
No,
it
right.
Won't just be announced that it's you know this
couple
one has
have
changed.
Changed.
Well, I thought that was a great handout. All right. Well,
actually,
was,
we could, what
we
could
we
do is
people.
Identify when we are making a change in the
yeah.
motion.
Yeah, we'll have as much explanatory material
yeah.
to make it a pleasurable town meeting experience. No, seriously, so people understand what's going on and can follow along.
And the more
yeah.
education, the better. Definitely.
At least.
And please, if you think of any questions, please get them to Wendy, because we want to make sure that legal counsel has time to get fixed stuff before the town meeting.
Yeah, we got all the.
And the 19th is our we're going to have a public viewing of the everything. So.
19th?
The 19th
pre-town
is our pre-town meeting.
Pre-town.
6:30. It will be our regular selectmen's meeting. So we want to make sure if you have any questions or if you want to make comments on, you know, explanations of why you did something.
Last year you had the committees involved in it. Is that the case this year?
I think we're going to do a combination. I didn't think it was helpful just to read numbers. People didn't have any context. So, but it was better to have some numbers, so it would be a combination of the last 2 years that we had, because it would, there was some, you know, it was totally different with Casey versus Doug.
No, I understand.
And so I think a combination of the two is better. Do you agree? I mean, you guys are, I think it was very boring and not very explanatory just to list numbers. I think there should be some context.
What I'd like to know what kind of what works best, what you'd like to see.
Well, I mean, there's an explanation of the like the pie chart. What are the expenses of the town? What is the revenue of the town?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's important to have context for people.
In layman's terms, that people
yeah,
understand.
Yeah, so people
yep.
understand and what
for me.
What we're doing.
I was going to say for me.
So we can go through this, and you know. The select board really didn't have that much input in the budget this year. It's okay because it's pretty much we went with what we did last year. So, but there are
okay.
some change. There's some changes that, you know, we should talk about as being aware, in case you know things happen, or what's coming down the pike. This will be impacted. This budget or whatever, like the federal budget, would impact probably Chapter 70. So what is that? How much do we get from the state? I think that should be a discussion we have. And it's been level funded. And it's been level funded, essentially, for years.
Yeah.
Whereas the cost of educating a child has been going up. And so where does the burden fall? It falls on the taxpayers. And so people need to understand why, you know, they're not seeing increase in services, even though you're paying a lot more in taxes. You know, I mean, the municipal budget is the one that's been being squeezed. So you can't demand. I mean, there's got to be some connection when, you know, people call up and say, you know, want to know how come the streets aren't cleaned off immediately.
Yeah,
and trees
sidewalks.
Planted, and I mean, there's, you know, there has to be a connection of what, how we're spending our money. We're very, we watch the budgets incredibly closely, I think, and we do a pretty good job, but people need to understand what's happening.
As I tried to explain the other night, I think there's a little bit of disconnect, not on everybody's part. I think a lot of people do understand, but I think some people don't understand. They see, they number one, hear the term free cash.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? You know, what is that the note? Free cash.
Right.
And so I think some people have a misunderstanding of what free cash is and how it's used in this town. And I think a lot of people miss that. That's carried forward to reduce the tax rate or the budget the following year. And that so-called free cash usually has a purpose for it. So when we carry, as John said the other night, you know, about 5%, you don't want to shortchange yourself, because if an emergency does come up, you need some money on hand. But I think some people look at that as, well, the town can afford it because they have X amount of dollars in free cash.
It's all free.
And that's great. And that's really not the case at all when you look at that. And so sometimes, you know, yeah, you know, we're going to do okay this year, I think. But down the road, that free cash, and you know, the schools, I understand, they're feeling the squeeze, and they're spending money that they've never spent before or have been very careful about spending.
Yep.
And so eventually they're going to hit the wall too, and it's not going to be that far in the distance.
Really
no, next year. Yeah. Next year is the year I feel it's going to be
for
terrible.
For some way, shape, or form, I wish we could explain that
do
a little
small,
bit
better. Do a small education thing.
Should we have a school to come? Administrator?
Yeah, so I was going to ask.
What do you think?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
My question, who are you asking to attend this meeting and potentially support the budget that they're presenting?
On the 18th, on the 19th, you mean?
Yes.
Maybe we should ask the schools to come and talk
maybe
about
the personnel chair, because they're presenting a new compensation plan and longevity. That's new this year.
Yeah.
People need to know that.
We could get, maybe Mary would do a quick explanation.
I'm just saying that if you're going to have discuss the articles, anybody that has any
background
to it.
But see, that, I mean, that's a good input, because that is what, we did more of that the first year and not talked about the numbers. And then last year we just talked about the numbers. Right. And I think a combination of both is better. So that reassures me that you agree with that. So. We'll sort that out. I think we should have someone from the schools, because I believe, didn't we, when we did it the first year, we had someone from the schools, didn't we? They didn't come last year?
No.
No, but they came the first year. So maybe we could get someone to talk about the schools,
mm-hmm.
at least the elementary school.
Right.
And hopefully we get someone to talk about Frontier.
Well, we have, I mean, there's Franklin Tech, which we don't have.
I know, but.
There's budgets, which you can't have everybody. But if we're proposing something new, I think the chairman of the committee that proposed something new needs to be able to describe why it's needed and why the rate increases low.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about the compensation here.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. No, that makes total sense, Bruce. That's wonderful. That's a wonderful suggestion. Can you think of anything else that we should include?
I just wrote through the warrant articles.
Yeah.
And
the
point.
Point of it is really to go through the warrant and explain things to people.
Right.
So.
Yeah, but I still
general education.
It's a big one. You know,
yeah.
The highway department, maybe they can explain why they use so much.
Right.
Yeah.
Is it a 75% increase in salt cost?
Yeah.
Who knows?
Right.
Well, no, that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can have Kevin do it.
The more education you can get out to your citizens, the better, so they know what's coming.
Well, the idea is not to also at town meeting night is not. You've
not
tried
the
to
time
address
to do it all.
Right. You've tried to address the questions, and if questions occur that you don't have the answer, you can get the answer to people, so that you're not sitting there thinking, looking not
right.
too swift because you don't have the information.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just curious, what kind of turnout you've had in for these?
I think the first year we had a really good turnout.
How do we bill it as like a pre meeting, town meeting?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. pre-town.
You really have to get the word out.
A lot of towns do it, and then they stop because nobody comes.
I know.
Well, last year was a pretty poor, I thought last year there wasn't very many people.
Right.
But.
That's the experience of most communities.
You do have to understand, there is actually quite an audience on the TV these days, too.
Right.
So even though there's not many people here.
They are watching.
There is a lot of people watching.
Yes, I think it's a very.
That's good to know.
Which is good.
Yeah, it is good.
I mean, I think it's really important that people understand that we're trying to do a really good job with what we have. And, you know, people come out night after night. You guys are here tonight.
Always.
And, you know, I think it's really important that people know that we're trying to be thoughtful and why we're making decisions the way we make decisions. So, okay. If you have any more suggestions, let Wendy know so that we can get ready for the 19th.
Or run with them.
Or, yeah. But it would be really nice if we could count on you guys to be here to answer questions from the finance point of view. It would be great. At least there'd be a few people. At least then there would be a few people in the audience. No, I think people. I think we'll have some people, but. I was disappointed there was less people last year.
We can entice them in with something somehow.
I know.
Raffle? Quote raffle?
I did do raffles one year. Remember,
did you
guys? I did radios. Remember, I went and wrote a small grant, and I got radios, and we were handing out radios.
Nice.
I made people call in, and they, you know, put names in, and we gave out radios, emergency radios.
Well, what you could do is say everybody that comes in fills out a little raffle ticket gets a $20 gift card to Dunkin' Donuts.
Or you write that grant.
Or sewer. $20.
Right to Dunkin' Donuts.
We don't have a petty cash draw. We can take $40 out of it.
No.
No.
Small
it's all donations. It's all donations. Personal donations. But no, I got a grant for the radios because they were really nice little radios.
Yeah, a little ham radio kind of thing. Sort of.
Yeah, those little crank-up ones.
Yeah, good.
And so I got a whole bunch of them. That was good.
Well,
so are you guys going home?
And Mark did that, too.
Yeah,
Mark
we'll probably stay.
Stuff.
We're going to. I make a motion to adjourn?
Yeah, no, we're done. Poor Wendy.
I'll second the motion.
Oh, man, Wendy.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I promised that I wouldn't reference
right
trying to.